today. Today is a big one. We are hosting one of the illustrious sons of this country from the legal fraternity. Mr. John Sangwa, State Counsel, is a partner at Smeza Sangwa and Partners, but is very well known as a civil activist and as a civil activist lawyer of many years. Mr. Sangwa, good morning and welcome to the conversation.
Good morning and thank you for the invitation.
Many people know you publicly for your especially public comments against authorities. You are like voice of the people on issues that can't be said, issues that people sometimes are afraid to bring out. I think the viewers would like to understand what makes John Sangwa. Who is John Sangwa?
Well, it's very difficult to describe oneself without sounding to be one blowing up his own trumpet. But I think to answer your question as to why I do what I do is, I think I'm driven more by my faith. I became a Christian at the age of 14. That's when I got saved. And I think everything has been driven from that point. And obviously, each one of us, we have our own different relationship with faith, with God and everything else. But for me, faith has informed everything in the sense that I look at myself simply as a vessel that the Lord uses. And as a vessel, the last thing that I'd be scared of is another flesh and blood, you know, so.
So your fearlessness, courage, is drawn from your faith. In fact, people may not even know that you are a Christian.
Yes, I am a Christian, and that's what informs everything. You know, if you know you are in Christ, I don't think at all there is any earthly authority that can scare you. You know, if you believe that God is able, God is great, there is nothing that is impossible with God. And if you truly have a sound relationship with God, I don't think at all there is any human being or earthly authority that you can actually be frightened of. But there's a difference between respecting and disrespecting authority. I respect authority, but when authority is wrong, I have no choice but to speak out. And in all these things, I look at myself as doing God's work. We are called to do many things. So I even look at my work as a lawyer as doing God's work. And I think It is from that perspective. It is that belief that informs everything that I do. And I serve God, and I believe the God I serve deserves the best. And I try and do the best that I can. And most of the time, I don't just wake up and open my mouth. I do listen to the Lord. I said, okay, this is the time to speak, and I speak. And when it is time to stay quiet, I stay quiet.
Wow.
Yeah.
That is surprising, because there are times when people want you to speak, and you're silent.
Yes.
And there are times when people think, well, I think John has accepted the situation, and from nowhere you drop a bombshell on the nation. Let's walk back. Yes. Many for us in the media fraternity would remember you, because you speak truth to power, would remember you as a young lawyer taking on the presidency. I think there was an issue of former President Frederick Chiluba's son early in the 90s. Just tell us about that, because that's when people begin to see your activism.
I think my commitment to try and to these issues started long before that. I think I finished the school at a very exciting period of time. We had spent 27 years of Kaunda's rule, and by 1989, it was clear that the one-party system had failed, and there was serious agitation for return to a multi-party system of government. And I think those of us who lived that under that period, we realized that, you see, whatever freedoms you enjoyed was what was allowed to you by the government. Okay, so we often looked over our shoulders to see who's behind you. We chose what to say and where to say what you wanted to say. And even at university, it was very obvious. We didn't have anything like academic freedom and so forth. You always knew that there were some intelligence officers in the classroom. Now, it wasn't a very nice period. But when we realized that there was failure of the one-party state, if I may just talk about that.
Yes.
You see, the collapse, most people lose sense of history.
Mm.
And then when you forget that as a country, you forget your history, you are lost. You see, the collapse of, and that is why some of the political parties now who are campaigning certain philosophies now, we have tried them before. And it's only those who have no respect for history that sometimes may get confused. But the one-party system didn't deliver. And so the collapse of the one-party state, it was a combination of factors, both internal and external. The external factors was basically the collapse of the Soviet Union. The Berlin Wall came down, Soviet Union came down. Then there was, I think if you remember this, Nicolae Ceaușescu,
yes,
was arrested, shot, and I think he and his wife were arrested and executed literally
on the streets.
On the streets,
the bodies paraded.
Yes, and Kaunda was very close to the Romanians,
yeah.
And obviously it was a triumph of liberal democracy and free market ideas, basically that carried the day. And internally, the promises that were made, the objectives or goals that the one-party state was supposed to achieve, had failed.
Yeah.
You know, so even when you remind people today, what happened was we got a very strong economy at independence. And when you look at statistically, Zambia had the second... It was the second richest country in Africa at independence in 1964. Mm, mm. On a GDP basis, it was beaten only by Libya, if you check the statistics. On a GDP basis, and people don't know these statistics, Zambia's GDP in 1964 was about $232. I don't know whether you have checked this. You know what the Chinese GDP was in 64?
Yeah, per capita.
Mm. Per capita. GDP per capita, $85.
We were richer than China.
We were richer than China.
We were richer than Singapore.
We were richer than Singapore.
We were richer than Malaysia.
Exactly. All these other countries, on a per capita basis, were a rich country. But after 27 years of Kaunda's rule, we ended up being... classified as the least developed and worst indebted country in the world. Our debt per capita was $700. Debt per capita, you take
percent.
Yes. From a positive GDP per capita,
yes,
you now ended up with a debt per capita. I mean, people sometimes, when you have no respect for history, you always have these challenges. The debt was well in excess of $7 billion.
Our foreign debt, yes.
And population was about 10 million or so. I think slightly less than that. So when you divide the total external debt by the population, you ended up... So the external debt, you can divide it by the population, we ended up at 700 dollars.
Mm. Mm. Yeah.
So infrastructure was broken down.
Yeah.
Other parastatal companies were bankrupt. And people, school children were actually sitting on the floor. And most of the schools in the country had no windows. We are getting those sacks, which we use for millimeter.
Yeah.
Those were the things we are covering on some of
when
the
it's raining and
windows to some schools. The road network was gone, no medicines in hospitals, and people were queuing up to buy millimeter. And you couldn't even buy, and I remember, this may sound funny, there was a time when everybody in the country was smelling the same.
Yeah. To a Samba life, bro. They are red.
That's right. And those who are,
unless you worked for Zambia Airways.
That's right. Mm. And those who had a bit of money, you'd buy choice. Yeah. I think you remember the there was a choice song.
There was rope.
Rope, which was made. Yeah. Mm. So people said, we deserve better. Mm. And that is why sometimes I get surprised when people bring up the issue of tribalism and regionalism. When the country collapses, it doesn't affect one region or one tribe.
We all all.
It affects us all. And obviously, there was no agitation for return to a multi-party system of government, because the argument is that, hey, we've tried one-party state, and it has failed. And I remember it was 1989, the first person that called for the return to a multi-party system of government was President Chilombo.
Yeah.
And we all thought, this man is crazy. How can he stand up to Super Kane?
Mm.
So, but again, from there, obviously, everything gathered momentum. And Kaunda was gracious enough. And it was a very interesting period. Because you see, and that's why when you have these leaders who come, they don't understand where power lies.
Yeah.
Power doesn't lie in state arms. Power lies
with the people.
And for the first time in my life, I felt sorry for Kaunda, because Kaunda had lost control. Kaunda was dictating what was to happen for 27 years. He dictated. All of a sudden now you find Kaunda had lost control. He was now reacting to things. To events now. The momentum was so huge that he decided to say, okay, let me find a way to placate people. And he came up with the idea to say, okay, fine, you want multi-party system of government. Let's go to a referendum. And
Council, just a recap there. 1988,
yes.
Dr. Kaunda goes to an election.
Yes.
He's popularly elected.
Yes.
I think 94%.
Yes.
Of course, a frog got something
yes,
as well.
That's right.
Within a year, ZCTU, you know, the largest union in the country, then have a congress in Livingstone, and they call for return to multi-party state. Here is the president taking comfort in the deception that is being popularly elected. And a year later, people are now calling for multi-party state. And now you're at a referendum stage.
Mm.
You are right. He has lost control. He's reacting to the coup that happened at an agricultural show in Angola. The events are overwhelming him.
That's right.
And for people that who read history, they will not understand. This man has just come from an election.
Yes.
The next election is 1993.
Yes.
Now this is 89 and 90.
Yes.
People are demanding for early elections, return to multi-party state. How did that occur?
Well, like I said, it was a combination of external events. Okay. External events now, like the collapse of the Soviet Union, because we had always been non-aligned.
Yeah.
And so now you see, because nobody ever imagined that the Soviet Union would collapse. Nobody ever imagined that the Berlin Wall would actually
come down.
Nobody ever imagined that people like Ceausescu would be rounded up and shot in the street like just like an animal. Come.
Yeah, like a dog. Know?
So those events emboldened the people inside. Now, the entire one-party system was rooted on fear. Now, when you run government on fear, and when people stop, that fear is gone, the system is gone. And that is why you see it was a very short period. Because these systems that are run on oppression, they don't have deep roots. They're very superficial. And the leaders live in a bubble. And that is why democracy still remains the best experiment. And if you are a leader, the last thing you can do is to try and stifle your people. Allow them to speak freely. Allow them to ventilate.
Let freedoms flourish.
Yes. And because through that, if you pay attention, you'd always be ahead of them. Because you can see the mood says, here things are not okay. But when you suppress, you oppress your people, you're not able to read the mood. You know, when I interact with people, you know, the people that make me nervous, those who don't talk, they make me nervous.
Yeah.
Because you can't read them.
I see.
You can't read them. Okay. So, and if you can't read them, then you can't know them.
Because you can't know what they're thinking.
You don't know what they're thinking. And that is why democracies encourage freedom. Speak freely. You can go to the UK and sit at Trafalgar Square and insult the king and whatever.
Yeah.
Hey, you have ventilated yourself. You have released the pressure and then you go home. Tomorrow you come back and insult. Nobody has died, you know. But insecure governments, they try to stifle. They don't realize that the trick to their longevity is freedom.
Yeah.
Okay? That is the answer. When you want to live long, democracy survive longer through freedom, not through oppression. No, you know.
Did you play any role during this transition?
During this particular period,
as a young lawyer,
yes,
you just
it was
from
an
university.
Exciting. Yes, it was an exciting period, and I just finished law school. Then I finished law school in 1989, and then. 1990, I was now at Ziale, so there was now these arguments now. Kaunda wanted a referendum. Then I remember that was the time.
And the question was?
Do we go to multi-party state?
Or we remain as a one?
Or remain one-party state. And I remember my first last meeting I attended, it was at Ridgeway campus.
Yeah.
Law Association called an EGM. I think by that time I was at Ziale. And I remember, though, I don't know whether you recall this minister. It was a minister of finance, Gibson Chigaga.
Yes, yes.
He came to that meeting and he said...
He was a lawyer by profession.
He was a lawyer by profession.
But he was Minister of Finance.
Yes, you can see how twisted our system was anyway. But these were solid men. Okay, but at least you wouldn't accuse them of corruption anyway. If you wouldn't actually use the word corruption
on them in the same sentence.
Not these characters we have today. there's a huge difference between the people that served under Kaunda and Kaunda himself. They got it wrong, not because they were crooks. Not because they were dishonest, but I think their problem was the inability to adapt.
What did Chigaga do to that EGM?
So he comes to the EGM to say, no, Lars, this is a political matter. You can't take a position. So now Lars wanted to take a position. How do we address this issue? So that was now the debate that because now they said Lars had to take a position. Are we for the return to multi-party system or retention of one-party state? So that EGM was called for Lars to pass a resolution.
For our people, EGM means extraordinary. Not your ordinary.
That's right.
General
yes.
conference.
Yeah, because it was created by dictated by the
events.
Yes. Chigaga came and said, "No, you're a legal profession. That's a political issue." We put it to a debate. People said, no, this is not a necessary political issue. It's actually a legal issue. So Chikaga was overwhelmed, and the meeting resolved to go ahead and resolved to go to a multi-party.
To support the calls for multi-party status.
Yes, and in fact, the argument of Lars, which carried the day, Lars has always played a role in the history of this country, but of course, sometimes it had failed in playing that role. Lars went further. He said, actually, we don't even need a referendum. We didn't go to a referendum when you changed from multi-party
to
in 1972 to one-party state. We didn't have a referendum. So why do we need a referendum? The same way we did
we
it
were
in
taken to a one-party state.
It's the same way you...
Wow. So the amendment to Article 4 by Parliament arises from pressure like that of Lars.
Exactly.
That said, abandon the referendum.
That's right.
It was, I think, a delaying tactic by the government.
Yes, Chikaunda, yes.
They wanted the political temperature to somehow calm
exactly.
down.
Exactly. But the horse had already bolted.
Mm.
You know, I know that Kaunda called a committee of UNIP, which was headed by, I think, General Himbe, which was put together to say, how do we reform one-party state?
Yeah.
Okay, that was even a report that was prepared. And all those were tactics to delay, thinking that will bring down the temperature. But once people are freed, you can't contain them. You know, Kaunda had lost control. Mm. And the subsequent attempted coup by, I think that was the Luchembe coup.
Yes.
But not that it was a planned coup anyway. But that's a story for
another day.
Yeah. But that unnerved Kaunda. And he came back to try and placate people. That's how he ended up releasing people like Edward Shamwana and other people.
General Tembo and
General
other
Tembo,
suspects.
Yes, to try and to bring about reconciliation in the country. But the temperature had already gone up. And that was my first baptism to the Zambian politics.
Mm.
That was 1990 at Ridgeway campus. Then thereafter events unfolded. And
so the Kaunda is defeated. We literally have new angels in State House and in power, people that are promising freedom and that freedom will flourish. But you were one of the earliest people to begin to sound the alarm.
Mm.
The prosecution, for example, of President Frederick Chiluba's son.
Mm.
When Dr. Kaunda was declared stateless, I think in 1993, you went on the side of Dr. Kaunda. It's like you saw it early, that these angels that have come appear to be taking the same path that was rejected in the past.
That is correct. What is actually interesting is this. After 1990, I was privileged to attend the CHOGAM. There was a CHOGAM conference in, I think, Zimbabwe.
Yeah.
That was, I think, 91 or 90.
Mm.
And
CHOGAM for our people is Commonwealth Heads of Government. It's a Commonwealth meeting where the Queen comes or his representative or her representative. It's a big meeting for the Commonwealth.
That's right. Mm. So normally there is a lawyers' conference ahead
alongside
of CHOGAM.
Yes.
So that one, I think, was 1990, and we had already decided to go to a multi-party system. That was my proudest moment to be a Zambian.
Because we're pioneers in Africa.
We pioneered.
The entire Africa was under either dictatorship or one-party state.
That's right.
And they couldn't understand how Zambia had done it.
We were the darling of the conference.
Everyone wanted to speak
to
a Zambian.
To speak to us. I said, guys, how did you manage?
Yeah.
How did you manage? By that time, I think I wouldn't even missed that CHOGAM because it was in the middle of the election.
Mm.
I think CHOGAM was in about September, And the elections were scheduled for, I think, October.
In November 1.
November. No,
yeah, October, end of October,
end
October 31st.
End of October, yes.
Because remember, KK would won, come November 1.
Yes.
Come November
1.
That's
right. So it made us very proud to go there. And I remember our colleague, I met some colleague from Malawi, Musisha, I think you know him, is a very prominent lawyer
in
Malawi.
Yes.
That was the first time I met him. So we're all proudly talking about events in our country. Then Musisha comes up and to present. So we're supposed to give status reports from our respective countries.
Yeah.
So Musisha started talking about something else. So then somebody in the conference said, Bwana, you're supposed to tell us what is happening in Malawi.
That's the theme.
Musisha said, no, this is what I've prepared. They tried to insist. No, Musisha stuck to his script. So, unknown to us, they were actually young pioneers. I don't know, people.
So the young pioneers were these from Kamuzubanda's party.
Yeah.
From the party intelligence. They were extremely ruthless.
Ruthless.
Yeah.
So some had been sent just
to watch what he was going to say.
That is how brutal these regimes were. And Musisha knew that and he stuck to his script. And I remember one of the guys saying, you know what? One of the first rules of nature is one of
self-preservation.
So if Musisha is uncomfortable,
allow him.
But as for from Zambia,
were the heroes.
We are the megaphone. So that experience was an eye-opening experience, and we realized that, you see, a democracy cannot thrive without an enlightened people, an enlightened population. And when we came back, my partner and I, we formed Legal Resources Foundation.
Yeah.
That was going to be our contribution to the consolidation of democracy.
In the country. Speak briefly about Legal Resources Foundation. Yeah. What was it about? Because I think it grew so much.
It grew.
It was countrywide. I think you had presence, if not in every province.
In
you had
every
presence.
Province, yeah. Yes. So the idea was to bring about civic education to the people, to enlighten the people on their rights. Now, you cannot live in a democracy without knowing or understanding what your rights were.
Mm.
And also we provided general legal advice, but it was mostly a civic education organization. And the idea was to go throughout the country, but of course, due to limitation of resources, we simply say at least we should get to each province. And we had a presence. I think at the time, the Western government were more interested in Zambia.
Promotion of democracy.
Yes, because it was first, they were using Zambia as a guinea pig to try and see how much progress it was going to do in terms of consolidating democracy. And so we had a lot of funding. Mm. And I think at one time, our budget was about $3-4 million annually.
Wow.
As Legal Resources Foundation. Wow. And the only reason we succeeded because every cent was accounted for. Okay. So, but obviously up to a certain point, you have donor fatigue. Mm. And I think we ran it for almost, we created it, I think, in 92.
Mm.
So.
But the point is, you just didn't speak.
Yeah.
You took action.
We took action.
To promote democracy.
Exactly.
In the choice of your cases, like I talked about where KK is declared stateless.
Yes, yes.
Where the president has a rampaging son who's shooting.
Yes, that's right, yes.
So you took steps, and in this case you even formed a Legal Resource Foundation.
Yes, through Legal Resources Foundation, we said those people didn't have resources could come if they have an issue.
Mm.
If need be, we'll take the case for them.
You were literally like legal aid.
Legal aid. That was what it was. And this was our contribution. Because a democracy cannot thrive if people are ignorant.
True.
And that is why I keep making noise all the time to try and enlighten the people. My only wish is that, you know, I wish I could gather all the Zambians, put them in a stadium, and tell them about what their rights are and what they should expect from their government. But I don't have that kind of opportunity. But whenever I have such an opportunity like this, I hope this will be widely circulated so that people can understand that a democracy, for it to survive, it has to be defended. it has to be protected. It cannot survive on its own. You don't just declare yourself to say we're a democracy and then that's it. No, you
Dr. Chiluba was a very popular leader,
yes.
Very celebrated
yes.
leader. But by 1996, things had fallen apart.
Yes.
You know, we see you are defending one of the political parties, I think, Honorable Dean Mungomba, who was a friend to Dr. Chiluba, you know, one of the founders of the MMD, but had fallen out. And by 1996, at his own political party, I think they were again tumultuous event. We had a new constitution that was passed, controversial new constitution, that barred Dr. Kaunda to stand, because UNIPOT was at the verge of a comeback.
We went, not even a verge.
Yeah.
You know, we'll talk about that.
Yeah.
Maybe. Let me just backtrack a little bit.
Yeah.
The first experience with this thing was after we formed Legal Resources Foundation, Dr. Chiluba's son, Castro, went in a pub and shot a girl. He was moving around with a gun. So the police could not do anything.
He's the son of the president.
He's the son of the president. We say, hell no. President or no president, we are all equal before the law. Okay? We said there are systems in place. This girl came to us. We said, no, we'll do private prosecution. That was
because when the DPP was not willing to take
You're
the
not
case,
willing.
The police, other than taking statements, were not willing to prosecute the matter.
Nothing. Anyway, so we dragged Castro to court. Castro came. So the day we are supposed to go for trial, this young lady came. What happened? Says, no, my family and Castro's family met. Mm. I've just decided to forgive him. And I said, no, you don't forgive him like that. But later on we learned that that's right, Mingalato had been done, you know. Then I said, okay, at least that is your choice because we...
But you demonstrated the point.
The point.
No one is above the law.
Nobody's above the law. Mm. No one is above the law. That was our first stint. The second one was when there was this crazy idea to bar Kaunda. There were all these machinations where... With the collusion of some judges, Kaunda ended up being declared stateless.
A man that had been president for 27 years.
Ambassador, that
a
was...
A man that had engaged in politics, I think from 1953,
exactly.
In fight of this country.
That's right. And all
so
of a sudden.
So 27 plus prior 10 years before that, so 37 years of his life was dedicated to saving Zambia.
Yes.
And the judge says he's
stateless. He's not Zambian. Is not Zambian. Huh? Malawi also.
Why did that outrage you?
Well, first, you don't treat people like that. That is how I saw my first experience of how a government left alone, how destructive it can be. That was my frightening experience about how the collusion, how harmful the collusion between the executive and the judiciary, how harmful it can be. Because clearly this was doctored. There were some very adventurous judges who colluded with the executive branch of government.
So they were looking at Kaunda's possible return in the 1996 election.
They started long before that.
Yeah.
Long before that. And Ambassador, I can tell you that was the beginning of the decline of our candle light as the democracy started dimming. Because when we went back to international conferences, people there said, turn around and say, you Zambians,
what's happening?
What the hell are you doing? How can you declare somebody who ruled your country, fought for independence, now all of a sudden is a foreigner? And how did you allow yourself to be ruled by a foreigner in the first place? So it was a crazy thing which we couldn't actually explain. So at international conference, it was even you had to hide your face to when you identify yourself.
From a shining light, now we're being, you know.
That's right.
Like how a democracy can quickly go wrong.
Exactly. If people are not vigilant. And that is why I keep making noise. I've had the benefit of this experience, whereas the younger generation have not had that. And my generation, some of them, they believe that they would rather make their money quietly than ruffling the feathers and so forth. But I do believe that even your ability to make money is dependent upon the environment. Okay, if the country goes up in flames, nobody will make money. So you need to protect the country first. So that's what happened. Then we said, no, this is wrong. You can't do this. Yes, you have the might, you have the power, and government can create anything. We know that, if they want to. Then, fortunately, there was some intervention and everything else, and then that move was abandoned. Yes. Then came, there are parallels, by the way. It's only those who don't know history. There are parallels between 1991 and 96, and 2021 and 2026.
Draw us to the comparison, or maybe you come later.
Then
you,
we'll talk about it later.
Yeah, I need to note it
and
so that I come.
That is why I keep making noise, because I can see. President Hichilema is in the same position that Frederick Chiluba was in 91.
Yeah.
There are parallels. The only difference is 30 years apart. Now, the only problem is that he's not a student of history. If he was a student of history, he would have done a far much better job than he has done. He's not a student of history. He has learned nothing, you know. But anyway, our biggest problem after that Kaunda experience, then there was a breakaway from MMD. Yeah. But let me just backtrack. You know, you know, democracy still remains the best experiment ever. And people underestimated Chiluba.
Yeah.
And the choice of Chiluba's president was not an accident. All the leaders of MMD knew that amongst all of them, Chiluba had the presence. There was only one person who was known countrywide, and that was Chiluba, because of his position as...
By 1991.
Yes, because of his position as...
The CTU president.
That's right. And he was known to
be... And a vocal, vibrant,
vocal,
and fearless.
Fearless guy. And this was a man where Kaunda used to say, how can he a what?
A 4 feet.
A 4 feet.
Because Kaunda was this tall man.
Giant of a man.
Giant of a man, huge stature. And Dr. Chiluba was of miniature stature.
Exactly. So, but everybody knew Chiluba.
Yeah.
So, you know, it was, again, people indecency in politics. You know, it's like people wanted to use Chiluba. It's like you see something in a sewage. You don't want to go in there, but you're waiting for somebody to pick it up out of the sewage, clean it up, and then you grab it.
Yeah.
That was the mentality of the people that surrounded.
They thought they were getting a compromise candidate they can replace later.
Exactly. So they thought, no. Okay, he has gotten rid of Kaunda. Now, thereafter, it is now our time now. Because they looked at him as a temporal president. And that's where there are all these moves and so forth. So when there was a breakaway from, I think Zadeko was there. I think there were several others. I think you remember Kachoka.
Yes.
There were all those, Bodwin Kumbula broke away.
Yes, yes.
Akashambada.
National Party.
Akashambada. Aka broke
away. Agenda for Zambia.
Yes. So they all became, because now it was a democracy.
Mm.
Before that, it couldn't exist. So a movement was necessary. But for some reason, and this is why there are some of the parallels that were there, Chiluba was more frightened of Kaunda
than any of these small breakaways.
Just like HH appears to be more frightened of...
With the patriotic front.
Yes. So all these fears are unfounded, and these are the parallels that I'm talking about. And I remember... there was now the initiation of the constitution-making process.
Yeah.
Because the 1991 constitution was a compromise constitution.
Mm.
Because what had happened...
From the Patrick Mvunga Commission.
Yes. Mm-hmm. What had happened was Kaunda had appointed all the commissioners to come up with a constitution. Then MMD said, no way, we don't recognize this constitution. Mm-hmm. Because tailored after Kaunda, and it was... It had Kaunda in mind in the drafting of some of the provisions and so forth. Then there was MMD threatened to boycott the election of 1991. Yes. Then there was a conference that was held at the cathedral.
The church, which was organized by... really was a sort of the earth.
Yes.
Because they could bring all parties
That's
together.
That's right. So the outcome, in fact, that draft constitution was actually being debated in the National Assembly. It had to be pulled out. Mm-hmm. So then the compromise was agreed to, but the understanding was that this is just for purposes
but there was magnanimity by Dr. Kaunda.
Yes.
The constitutional amendments is on the floor of the House.
Yes.
A political meeting is called.
Yes.
The compromises and clauses that arise from that meeting are then infused in this constitution.
That's right. You know, in all these things, I think when we have a proper assessment of our democracy, I think the greatest credit goes to Kaunda.
Yes. Look at the concessions he was making.
He made serious concessions. He lost it along the way, but he still respected the will of the people. And he said, oh, this is what you want. Okay, you can have it. This is what you want. You want multi-party? Okay, you can have it. Or you want...
Let's go to elections.
Let's go to elections. Let's have it.
And you want a new constitution?
You can get it. So... Then there was that compromise, but the problem was Chiluwa inherited a very bad economy.
Yeah, yeah.
Very bad. Not like this. This is even better, where you can even have coffee and bottled water and tea and so forth. You can walk in a shop and buy anything. The only constraint
will be the price.
Not even the price, your pocket.
Yeah, true.
Those days, even with money in your pocket, you can't find what you wanted. So, Bachelor was honest enough, which unfortunately is a trait that HH is.
Doesn't have.
And Chiluba went to the people and said, guys, things are bad. And they were bad. Literally everything was broken. You know? And it was now a question of rebuilding. Now, once you have wrecked your economy, it means you're irresponsible. Now, if you go to lenders, lenders will impose conditions to bring about fiscal discipline. And that meant you doing certain things, removing subsidies and so forth. Those policies by Dr. Kaunda actually destroyed people's lives. People died, mostly out of depression and so forth. But... there was no option anyway. There was no any
other way.
Just like now, we have no any other way than to restructure the debt and everything else. But here, at least you have several options because these things are not as broken as they
were
in
1991.
Now, then Chiluba reluctantly, first of all, after getting into power, he realized, well, this constitution is not as bad as we thought it was. So he didn't immediately appoint the commission, as was the agreement. He was forced under pressure to appoint Wanakatwe. I think this was now 93.
4 years later, yeah.
93, 94. Yes. So, and that's how people like Bodu Nkumbula, Aka, and the rest gave failure to put together a commission as one of the reasons for leaving the party. That was a departure from the understanding of what was the understanding when they went into government. Halfway through that constitution-making process, Kaunda came on the scene. Because the reforms were now biting
our people.
People were now crying.
Because now there was a privatization program in full flight.
That was a full force.
Companies were being sold, were being liquidated, were under receiver management. People were losing jobs. It's a painful process.
Painful, but necessary. So the cries were widespread. Now, I think kind of misread those cries, like it's a call for his return.
They miss me.
You know? But he now decided to say, no. So now he was telling, remind, you see, I warned you, these multi-party people, they thought they would do a good job. Mm-hmm. Look at what they are doing. Mm-hmm. What and what. And that was his call. And Kaunda went round the country in, I think that would have been 94.
And before that, you know, there was a proper transition.
Yes.
We have a democracy. The MMD are now a ruling party. UNIP began its reforms. It even went to Namayani for a conference of their own, where they elected, I think, Kevin Sokotwane,
yes, as leader of UNIP, yes.
And yeah. I think then later Nkoma. Yes. But then Kaunda returned.
Yes. Kaunda returned. So what happened then, I think this was not towards 95. Yeah. Kaunda left in, he didn't immediately leave. I think Kaunda left in 92, 93. Mm. So during that period of agitation when the reforms were biting, he saw an opportunity. Mm. But there was too internal democracy within UNIP because they went for another conference where Kaunda stood with Kebi and Kebi lost. Kaunda came back.
Mm.
It wasn't some kind of anointing going on. No, yeah. There was actually an election.
They called for a fresh election in the party.
Yes, and Kaunda came back. That was, I think, 95. And that brought about panic.
From the MMD and Chiluba's. But many people, you know, if you had asked experts and pandits and followers of history, they would have said Chiluba was still extremely popular.
Exactly.
He was still going to beat Kaunda on the ballot.
Hands down.
So where was the apprehension?
You know, this is what I fail to understand about politicians. They have faith in people whilst going in office.
Mm.
When they get elected, they have faith in the people. But for somewhere along the way, they lose faith in the people. They don't think people can re-elect them.
Yeah.
That's where the problem is, and I cannot understand this. But there is something that the late John Mwanakatwe told me, but those days in my years as activist. So when there was not this process was being done, there should have been a completely new constitution to replace the 1991. Then obviously Chiluba with his advice, legal advisors in State House, they said, no, how do we scheme this?
Yeah.
Mwanakatwe had recommended that you take the constitution to a referendum.
Yeah.
A referendum you have no control. They said, no, we're not taking this to a referendum. Instead of a new constitution, we will amend.
We'll only do necessary amendments.
That's right. That was the beginning of the problem. And we went to court. We sued. That was 1996.
You sued?
We sued.
What was the question? What was the purpose of your petition?
We went to court and we said, it's a very famous case.
Mm.
We did two cases. One was, I think it's reported as Derek Chitala versus the Attorney General.
Mm.
We went to court. We said, no. What you are doing here is not an amendment. You are making a new constitution.
Under the guise
of an amendment. Which power you don't have?
That power belongs to the people.
That power belongs to the people, not to parliament. Parliament you can only amend. But you can't introduce it.
Because amendments were awesome, except for Part 3.
Part 3 and 79,
mm.
and which has now become a template now, which is completely wrong. And obviously, and that is why the history of this country has largely been shaped by an ineffective judiciary. The judiciary has betrayed the people along the way.
Yeah.
And in 96, of course, we went to court. But what was interesting about 96 was one of the issues that the people, Mwanakatwe was assigned to ask the people to determine, was the most popular way of enacting the constitution.
Mm, mm.
And Mwanakatwe came up with a report and said, enactment of the Constitution through the National Assembly was the least favored mode of adoption of the Constitution. Is there in the report?
Yeah, I think because that's the first time I heard about the word Constituent Assembly.
Yes.
Because the report was at first, either you go to the public through a full referendum.
That's right.
Or you go through a Constituent Assembly.
Exactly.
And Parliament was the least.
Was the least favored. Then Chiluba decides to take it to
the least favored.
So we said, no, you're violating the will of the people. Mm. That's how we went to court. And as usual, we lost. But when I know people say, I've lost more cases than I've won, it might be true. But those cases have been educational.
Yeah.
They've been
educational. They are novel cases.
They are novel cases. It is more the lessons. You see, when you win, you don't learn anything. Mm. When you lose, you learn more from those losses. Mm. And we take these cases, they are more for public education. They are known as public interest litigation.
You said something that the judiciary has let down this country so many times.
Yes.
In many cases, the loss of your cases is because you have a timid judiciary that don't want to respond to the will of the people.
Exactly.
But would rather please the executive.
The executive in power. That is where the problem is. And that continues to be the problem to this day. And then they don't forget the judges are appointed by the executive.
Mm.
So the executive, they appoint user-friendly judges. Unfortunately, that appears to be the trend. Anyway, so there is something very interesting. So when Mwanakatwe, so during that particular period, there was now a clause introduced to say, no, for you to stand as president, both your parents
must be born in Zambia.
Must be born in Zambia.
This law was specifically made to bar Dr. Kaunda.
Dr. Kaunda.
Because Dr. Kaunda is of heritage from Malawi. His parents came as missionaries in this country in 1909.
Yes.
And his parents clearly were not born from
But during that particular period, even the old law was nonsensical.
No, it wasn't.
Yeah,
no,
because there was no Zambia before that.
The Zambia started in 1964. Dr. Kaunda's parents came to Zambia in 1909.
Yes. And
then Dr. Kaunda was born here.
Yes. And when you look at the way the colonial government was run, normally the borders were very porous. People were traveling from here and so forth. And then there was really no respect for boundaries. And people, there was free movement during that particular period.
But no, the boundaries were driven by labor. Look, if you can get Malawians, Zimbabweans, or Tanzanian, or Mozambicans to go to work in Salisbury, Wange, or Copper Belt, that's what happened.
That's,
So
to the Africans, borders meant nothing.
Mm.
Okay. Mm. Borders were more beneficial for the settler interest.
Yeah.
When the British and the Portuguese are arguing the extent of their areas of influence, then that's where the borders were an issue.
Mm.
When the British and the Belgium Congo are arguing about the extent of their respective territories in northern Rhodesia and
it's just
Congo,
about resources.
About resources, really.
They want the ivory, they want the mineral resources.
Yeah.
Mm.
So
we are at 1996.
Yes.
And you know, there's this threat to Dr. Kaunda.
That's
he's literally
right.
been banned.
Yeah, but there was another clause in the Constitution which people don't talk about.
Mm-hmm.
That was a term limit clause.
Yes, because it was now cast in stone. Presidents will serve for 2 terms.
Yes, but under the 1991 Constitution, it was clearly stated that 2-term limit was to start with the 1991 Constitution.
Oh, that is why Dr. Kaunda was
eligible
to participate in 1996.
Yes.
So they had to double lock it.
Yes. So in 1996, they said, as long as you have been elected twice, you're not eligible.
Mm.
So even they didn't want to take any chances.
I see where your arguments come when you're arguing about President Lungu's eligibility.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, there is all that. I mean, unless if you're intellectually lazy. But there is already a very rich history to that effect. So I follow the amendment of that clause. That's how now, when Chiluba came in 96 to say, as long as you have been elected twice, it doesn't matter when.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he pushed the boundary back to 91, to 64.
Yeah.
As long as you have held the office of president twice, you're not eligible.
Was that legal? Making the law apply
retrospectively? It's the constitution. There's no superior law other than the constitution. And that was effected. Then I remember having a chat with the late John Manakato. When Manakato heard about this, he shared this with me. He went to see Chiluba. Mr. President, what are you doing? There is no way Kaunda would win.
Memories are still fresh with the
yes.
people.
Yes, and I said, oh, this, but even if you listen to Kaunda, he's saying he's coming back, like we're having the same thing.
Yeah.
But what is he going to do?
That he didn't do in 27 years.
Which he didn't do. It's not just a question of Kugwelelapo, but what is he going to do? He has no fresh ideas.
Mm.
But don't forget, he wrecked the economy and left you with the debt of $7 billion.
Which you are still struggling.
Which you are still struggling to fix. And that's the same thing. Today we're not talking about the $7 billion. We're talking about $15 billion. Mm. So, as usual, in his meek way, President Chiluba says, this is what was narrated to me. Yova Manakato, naumfwa, ati kaunda tetea wini. Okay. But what if he does?
You cannot take chances. Oh my. The fear of politicians when they occupy offices is
so
there was a remote possibility in his mind that Kaunda could be elected. But what if he's elected?
But the point is, what he removed from the equation is the people. Okay? The choice whether Kaunda comes back or not
was the people's
choice. He took that away from the people.
From the factors.
But that was not his right. And that is why even those who are talking about ECL coming back, that's his choice. Nobody has the right to take that away. Only the people. Okay? As long as he's eligible to be on the ballot,
let him be.
The
ultimate decision is the people.
Is that of the people. Just like you are put there by the people remove you. And that's why I said, you know, when most of these politicians get into power, they lose faith in the people that put them there. And they start doing all these crazy things that only serves
to alienate them away from the people.
Exactly. And they make them very unpopular, you know. And come the election, and these are the lessons. Even what is happening in PF happened in...
Under UNIP.
Under UNIP. But under UNIP, which was different, UNIP killed itself.
It was not a state.
No.
Mm.
The state targeted Kaunda. Kaunda's response was selfish and reckless. In my activist days, I knew, and also what is shocking is the naivety of the politicians or the opposition during that period. They were somewhat convinced that Chiluba would not sign that bill into law. Then I said, guys, what would stop? The bill has already gone through the National Assembly. All what is required is assent.
By the president.
In my activist days, then we decided to bring all the opposition leaders together. This was 96 at Lilai Lodge. I was working closely with Emily Skaz, Women for Change.
Yes.
Well, we brought them together. And my brother.
So the Kaundas, Din Mungomba.
Din Mungomba, Roger Chogwe, Rolf Shenton, Guy Scott, Humphrey Mulemba, all those political parties, we managed to bring them at Lilai Lodge. What we wanted was. Chiluba is not going to change his mind.
He will likely sign this into law, which will result in the barring of Dr. Kaunda.
That's right. What you now have to do is, how can you compete effectively but according to his own rules that he has set? And our plan was that, you see, there's so much focus on the presidency, but you're forgetting the National Assembly. There's only one seat for president. But the 150
seats
for MPs, if the opposition can work together and control the National Assembly, you paralyze the president. That was my first introduction to the selfishness of Zambian politicians.
Yeah. What was their response?
They all came. Then, the day of the conference, I heard in the night that Kaunda was having a press conference. And my plan was, our plan was, let Kaunda come.
Yeah.
They decide together
mm-hmm.
the way forward.
Mm-hmm.
But as usual, I mean, all these things that they're talking about, opposition alliances, they're all fake.
Yeah.
I mean, all these politicians by nature are just greedy characters, and they never act in the interest of the country. Kaunda decided to go at it alone.
Wow.
All the leaders.
Because UNIP was the largest political
was
party.
Was the largest political party.
And he had Stecher's former president.
Exactly.
You know, so.
He couldn't use that resource, those advantages, and give them to another political party for the good of the country. It was like, because I'm not taking part, nobody should. So finally, they came to Lilai after Kaunda had already. That was my first interaction with my dear brother, Mwabi Lungu.
Yeah.
I called him up, and maybe he's forgotten. I called him that evening. So, Mwabi, do not let your Central Committee make that decision. Come to the meeting.
This is a decision to boycott the election.
To boycott the election. There was a meeting at Simonson Building. That was when Simon Weir was, I think, member of the Central Committee.
Yes, he was. The former mayor, to this current Simon Weir.
Yes, he provided the offices, and they met there in the night. Then, the following day, there was BBC and everybody else, and obviously playing to the gallery, not deciding as to what was in the interest of the country. They announced that they were boycotting.
What did Mohabi Lungu say when you expressed your fear?
Yes, he says, no, it's a Central Committee decision and everything else. And I said, okay, fine. Then the following morning, that meeting of ours at Lilai Lodge was supposed to take place at 10. 10, Kaunda was not. All the leaders were gathered. Kaunda was nowhere to be seen. So we recognized Kaunda as a factor. We couldn't start a meeting without
him. Mm.
So finally, 1 o'clock, Kaunda trooped in. Mrs. Alumis
mm-hmm.
and the late Mary Fulano.
Yes.
They sat there. No, countrymen, we gentlemen, we have decided to boycott. They sat there. And that was my first disappointing experience with politicians. The inability to be selfless and do what is right for the country. Then I asked, they boycotted. I asked Mrs. Mary Fulano
mm-hmm.
and Zalumis, Mrs. Fulano and Mrs. Zalumis, you have decided to boycott. What next mm-hmm. after boycotting? They had absolutely no clue. It was boycott for the sake of boycott.
No, I think they wanted to use it as a political tool, that if they announce a boycott, it will take away the legitimacy of the elections. As you know, this issue are saying about politicians. So they expected Chiluba to be moral enough, maybe to cancel the elections. Remember, Dr. Kaunda had made all these concessions.
Yes.
Demands from the people and stakeholders, go to multi-party state, no referendum, call for early elections. Maybe he was in that mode where he thought when he takes the political action, then President Chiluba would realize maybe the legitimacy of his election would not be okay. But it was clearly misreading the ideas. The 1990-91 is the people that were calling the shots.
That's right.
In this case, it's UNIP that's calling the shots.
Exactly.
And your description of selfish, of politicians, then fits in properly.
Yes. And what happened was, actually, they had no clue. And guess who didn't attend?
Yeah.
Dini Mungomba.
Ah.
Dini Mungomba, you know, it's quite fascinating history. It's a very rich political history that we have.
Yes.
Dini Mungomba, for some reason, was more scared of Kaunda than of Chiluba.
Yeah.
So, with Kaunda out of the way,
he saw a win.
It was a win.
He saw a win.
He was already in between his house and the state house. For him, I'm sure he had even ordered the suit for the inauguration.
Because Kaunda really was a towering figure. Yes. And for all those that lived under him, he just paralyzed you. Just like you said about John Mwanakatwe,
yes.
Who had told Chiluba that, what if he wins?
Yes.
So even Dean, I think looking at a boycott is so a greatest opportunity.
That's right, but selfishness. Mm.
Yeah.
So you know who came? Azobanda.
Azobanda, yes. The Secretary General
at the time. And I didn't have kind words for him.
Mm.
We quarreled at that meeting, and I said, you know, I have no respect for people, I have no principles. Up to that time, all the political parties were agreed
together.
If Kaunda is bad, we are not taking part in the election. That was the agreement. But on that day, that agreement fizzled.
Because the boycott either should have been taken back or...
Or it could have only been... That was the understanding. That was the understanding.
Kaunda so Dean was supposed to be at the meeting to support the position of UNIP and KK to boycott.
Yes. Because you see, remember, Chiru had already signed that into law,
yes.
Which Kaunda was bad.
Mm.
So the position of the opposition leaders was that since Kaunda has been bad, we're not taking part
in the election.
But that unity that was there
immediately broke.
It evaporated. And what was worse, Kaunda could not even put aside his own interest and say, okay, guys, because our plan, what we are working on was, get the opposition parties to say, okay, UNIP is strong in Eastern Province. Do not field any other opposition candidate in that area. Dean, for example, gave the impression that he was strong in Northern Province.
Mm.
Give
and
him that.
Urban areas.
Amfrim Lembo strong in Northwestern province. Give him that. So that at least the opposition...
They salvage the MPs.
That was the thinking. Never worked. Selfishness as opposed to national interest prevailed. And what was worse, Kaunda said to his supporters, start burning voters' cards.
Yeah.
That is what killed UNIP.
And buried it. Because the members were very loyal.
They
turned up en masse at those rallies by Kaunda. The exercise was to burn voters' cards.
They burned the voters' cards.
They disenfranchised themselves,
exactly.
Including future by-elections and the subsequent elections like the 2001 elections.
That's what buried UNIP. It was not a targeted or state-sponsored activities to finish off UNIP, like what we are seeing now. Yeah, but this was just... I would say UNIP poisoned itself.
Mm.
That's what killed UNIP. Those are the differences. But the election came, and Dean thought he was going to win. And when the election came out, results, it was a bloodbath.
Yeah.
Bloodbath. I think up to that election, Dean had so much money. He invested so much, but the yield was negligible. I think he only got one or two seats or so in the election of 96. And that was my first experience with Zambian politicians. And that's why I have very little respect for all these alliances and so forth. So
what they say in the day is different from what they do in the night.
Yeah. Then we went I was told by these Zadeco people came after they lost, after they were thumped, thoroughly thumped.
Mm.
They came and says, no, the election was rigged.
Mm.
I won't mention names.
Yeah.
So one of the guys from Zadeco came sheepishly because they went against everything that we advised them.
Mm.
So they said, no, you see, election was lost. So how was it lost?
The ballot papers. Register.
Yes, Nikuv registered. And also the voters' ballot papers were chemically treated. So where you put
your
X for Zadeco, it disappears.
It migrated and went to the MMG. Chiluba. And they speak this with a lot of confidence.
Yes, and these educated people. Mm. And I said, I know science has advanced, but not to that level. Mm. To me, what you are describing sounds more like witchcraft than science. But then they came to us and we said, okay, if it was rigged. I said, but did you get a sample of that ballot?
Yeah.
Says, no. Mm. I said, okay, we will not go full-fledged into an election petition. We have to do some discoveries first to find out whether indeed there's credible evidence to back up rigging before filing the actual petition. The election petition of 1996 was just a silly face-saving measure.
Mm.
They showed unity after losing when that unity should have been
demonstrated before elections.
Before the election, which is always the case.
Mm.
So that was the experience we had with
the 1996
election. With the 1996 election, and there is no way Kaunda would have won that election. Yes, people were in pain, but Kaunda was not the answer because he was actually responsible for the mess in the first place.
Mm.
You know, but the biggest problem we have is the inability of the elected officials to trust the people that elected them.
Yeah, yeah. One, before we begin to review President Hakainde Hichilema's term of office, is served 2.5 years. One of your most difficult cases, the Chiluba case.
Yes.
President Mwanawasa, who's his anointed successor, President Chiluba spent a lot of time after the third term debacle collapses, handpicks this man who was previously his vice president. He becomes president.
Mm.
And immediately, Mwanawasa turns his guns on Chiluba. And I've never seen that propaganda where Chiluba was literally depicted as a thief and as a reason why people were poor, because he had walked away with the treasury, had looted the treasury. A man of your integrity, a man you and Robert Smeza, well known in this country, chose to go and defend that case.
Mm.
Why? What motivated you?
Well,
in fact, you know our dear brother, Fred Membe, he dedicated many days in editorials to try to dissuade you by insulting you, by repeating your own history and your contribution to this country, and like you were treacherous to the country by defending Frederick Chiluba.
Mm. You know, Ambassador, I've taken oath as a lawyer, and that oath is to defend the law. Again, it comes down to my faith. I didn't know President Chiluba was in office.
You actually fought him many times.
Yes, and during his term, we even went into hiding when Dean Mungombo was arrested for treason. Okay, we took out an application for habeas corpus, and people are now saying, who are these lawyers who have filed a writ asking us to produce Dean Mungombo? We haven't finished with him yet.
Yes.
We went into hiding for about 2 weeks. Came out. We came out the day when Dean Mungombo had to be produced in court.
That case, for our viewers, they may not know.
Mm.
After elections, political tensions proceeded into 1997.
Yes.
And there was a Captain Solo
coup,
in which then after interrogations and many soldiers were picked up, the political leadership were implicated. And this was Dr. Kaunda, Roger Chongwe, Dean Mungomba, and others.
Mm.
And I think that's where you are now, demanding for your client. Because Dean Mungomba has been your client from the election petition and from the elections.
Yes.
And now there's a coup attempt, there's treason case now against him.
Yeah.
Dr. Kaunda is under house arrest, and you're looking for Dean Mungomba.
That's
right. I just want to give you a quick background.
President Chiluba declared a state of emergency during that period. That's how these leaders were rounded up. So we went to court to challenge the declaration of a state of emergency.
Why? Well, there was a treason suspect.
Yes, we went to court because then after people were rounded up, President Chiluba went on national television and said, I am broadcasting from State House. Everything is fine. I am in control.
I'm president.
I am president. Then he declares a state of emergency. A few days later, we said, hey, you are in control. Why do you need a state of emergency? That was our first act.
Yeah.
Because that was basically an abuse. Because a state of emergency, it means that the country is still under some state of disturbance. But you told us, things are under control. Why do you need a state of emergency? And as usual, we lost because of the meekness of the judges. But again, it's more educational than anything else. Then that was our experience under President Chiluba. We never had any personal interaction with him.
Yeah.
And again,
we demanded Dean Mungumba, you're saying.
That's right, yes. Mm. So finally, when he was brought up, he had been badly beaten and tortured and so forth. And I think he contracted some other illnesses in jail. He never recovered. And I think that was the incident that took him early to the grave. Mm. But that is how, why people must always be able to pay attention. We have this mentality where we think as long as it is Ambassador Mwamba, it's okay.
It's not me.
Yeah, as long as it doesn't affect. No, you should actually be worried because after Ambassador Mwamba, it will be you. So brutality or abuse of power by government in any form should never be tolerated. And we have a duty to look out for one another. So you know how tables turn, which is, again, lessons that presidents don't learn, that when you're in State House, you're simply a tenant for a period. At some point, you leave. Don't forget that you're going to leave. Finally, President Chiluba
is out of office.
You may have created, and also it tells you the nature, just how treacherous we Zambians can be.
The system and Zambians are.
We can be. And through some series of events, like I said, the work I do, for me, I do God's work. And through some series of events, we ended up, we're introduced to President Chiluba. We didn't know him. Ambassador, I would not wish any president to be in the position of Frederick Chiluba. The man was so lonely. Everybody that he knew scampered.
Everyone he helped.
He prayed with scampered. He was alone. It was just his wife, Simeza, and I. You know, whereby at some point we're even saying, I think the line between a lawyer and a social worker
had been blurred.
So you didn't know.
Now remember, you'd come for ego work, end up staying almost.
We ended up staying because the man was so lonely. We said, you know, you can't put all these things to billable hours. They're not billable hours. You know, you go there for tea, the man is lonely, he calls you. Not that he has anything of substance to tell you, just because he's lonely.
Yeah.
Now, I know people celebrate President Mwanawasa. I do not, because I was on the other side.
You were at the heart of the cases.
Yes.
You were at the heart of the allegations.
Yes.
And of course, you were up a big mountain of propaganda against Chiluba. And the truth appeared buried. But there's a first whistle you blew. Mwanawasa went to Parliament, lifted Chiluba's immunity, I think, in July 2002. And he had catalogued various offenses, arms deals, all these millions of dollars, sale of Luansha Mines, $35 million, arms deal, $100 million. There were hundreds of millions of dollars. And you could understand the anger of Zambians.
Yes.
Because they felt Chiluba had really stolen these millions.
That's right.
Then they come to court.
Yeah.
They bring an issue that he has stolen $500,000.
Yeah, but before that, you know, this is a lesson. First of all, presidents need to know their boundaries. Okay? It's very dangerous to allow a president to comment on criminal matters or ongoing investigations. As president, you have appointed your Inspector General of Police. You have appointed your Director General of the Anti-Corruption Commission. You have appointed your DEC, law, internal law enforcement officers. You have appointed them. It is their responsibility to do the investigations.
Not you as president.
Not you as president. You should never, never comment on ongoing investigations because that is not interference. So the saddest part for me, I've never believed in fighting evil for evil. Worst mistake President Manawasa did was when the relationship soured between him and President Chiluba, he went to Parliament and made that catalog of allegations. And to that day, no formal investigation
had been done.
He went to hang Chiluba. Two things that I disagree with, even if assuming Chiluba had done that, he should have given Chiluba the benefit to explain himself. Nothing stopped President Mwanawasa from calling his predecessor to say, Mr. President, come. There is a dossier here which says you took money from Ramco, $35 million. That was the first mine to be privatized.
Yes.
Even if you were a thief. Mm. I mean, how do you even move money like that?
The first harvest.
The first harvest, you chew. I mean, come on. But all these things, but none of those allegations
were true.
Were true.
And they were not tested.
But even that ambassador, I cannot just come to you. Ambassador, by the way, you have done ABCD. Mm. No, if somebody tells me something, I'll come to you. Ambassador, this is what I've heard. What is your response? Even in basic journalism, you do that.
Yeah.
You pick up a story about somebody being alleged to have done something. You don't have a story. Mm. You have to go to that person to say, Bwana, my sources are saying this. What do you have to say?
The principles of fairness, principles of objectivity, principles of balance kick in immediately.
President Mwanawasa was not fair to Chiluba. Because if he had been, I don't think I thought the history of this country would have turned out the way it did. Now, there are always some benefits of these things if depending upon how you look at it. When that happened, you know, we're a country of extremes. People, if they had found Chiluba on the streets, they would have put a necklace around President Chiluba. That is how much emotion
we raised.
Was able to raise. Basically saying,
to whip
all your problems at Chiluba's. People were ready to basically burn
Chiluba. Lynch.
We went in. We said, no, the best thing is that let's allow reason to prevail. We went to court. Through those court actions, what and what, we were able to present the other side of the story.
Slowly.
Slowly, slowly, reason was prevailing. That period when we had the matter, we went to the National Assembly. We challenged the National, the removal of President Chiluba's immunity. And as usual, the judiciary betrayed him. There are some crazy judgments that were written by, I think, Chief Justice Sakala and so forth, which was fine. But
you managed to literally allow some of the cases to take place when the temperature had come down.
That's correct. That was the benefit.
When they lifted Chiluba's immunity, the police were at his gate to search and literally pick him up. And you came with this order from High Court, stopping the decision and staying the decision of Parliament. So there are many things you did.
There are many, many things.
By the time trial is starting 2004, 2005, I think people have seen through the lies.
That's right. The temperatures had come down. The temperature had come down. And one of the credits I have to acknowledge is the late George Kunda. He may have had his own imperfections.
He was Minister of Justice and Attorney General.
That's right. He was, I think, a fair man. That was the only voice of reason in the assembly, which was now agreeing that, yes, this man has not been given the opportunity to be heard. But there is a huge benefit from that Chiluba experience. That is why we have this very robust system of protecting former president which is President Lungu is now enjoying.
It came from the humiliation of Chiluba.
It came from that humiliation because we said, National Assembly, you needed to hear both sides of the story. You just heard President Mwanawasa's version. You didn't hear Chiluba's version. The argument was there is no provision in the assembly for an outsider to be heard. There's provision for the president to be heard, to address the assembly, but there's no provision for an outsider to be heard. So that has now been addressed, whereby if the president presents a report that his predecessor has committed his crimes, his predecessor has the right to appear before a committee of the National Assembly that will now report to the assembly so that they have both sides of the story.
These are now the new provisions.
These
in
are
the new
provisions, yes.
In the new other, constitution.
The other provision is that Chiluba's immunity was removed through a simple majority. Now you need two-thirds.
Majority.
Two-thirds. It's not the walk in the park. And that is why when President Ichilema says, my brother has nothing to worry about. No. Giving the impression that it is out of his magnanimity. No, he has the protection of the law to say. And now, first of all, there's a requirement that there must be a prima facie case
proven,
which you ought to present to the assembly.
Not just a report like
that. Not just a report, a dreamt up report. No, you now need a prima facie case, meaning there has to be a thorough investigation so that when the president goes to the assembly now to ask for the immunity to be removed, he has a detailed analysis to say, this law was broken, this law was broken. So basically, the internal security wings have done their investigation. There is already a case ready to go to trial. That's the only time you can remove the immunity. These are some of the things that, yes, you lose a case, but there are benefits that come out of it. You know, so I don't see these cases as losses, but I see them as a way of developing our jurisprudence. It may be a loss to me today. It's a benefit to President Lungu today.
And other presidents.
And other presidents. Maybe even HH himself.
Yes.
It will work for him, you see. So those are the benefits that have come out of this experience.
Briefly, before we analyze President Hakainde Hichilema's tenure, I'm at African Union.
Yes.
I'm Zambia's ambassador at the African Union, and I'm called that there's a report that has come from the UN about your country. And when I attend there, there's a United Nations special rapporteur on the independence of judges and lawyers. The special rapporteur is Diego Garcia Cyan, and they've thrashed this report. He has condemned Zambia. He has condemned the act of the judiciary. What has happened is on 13th March 2020, the Chief Justice writes, the judiciary writes to Lars to bar you that shouldn't appear before court, you shouldn't appear before any magistrate, before any tribunal. And it has, I was not aware. So the report is coming from the UN and it's being shared to me, you know, because I'm ambassador at the African Union. And there's even, they've put a background because even SADC had supported your position.
Yes.
Sometimes people and presidents are not aware of when they offend democracy, to what extent a country can be tarnished.
That's right.
So the President Lungu's administration could have maybe felt offended by your attacks, especially when you raise that issue of his eligibility, and, you know, inadvertently you are to criticize the judiciary and the constitutional court, and it ends you this ban.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, that was my experience,
mm-hmm.
where I'm being given a special report from the UN by the special rapporteur.
Mm.
Just speak to the criticism, because people don't understand. And I'm glad that from the time we've started discussing, you have been very fierce critics when the law has been offended,
mm-hmm.
when the constitution has been offended.
Mm-hmm.
You don't raise issues because you are partisan against Mwanawasa, or you're partisan against Chiluba, or you're partisan against Edgar Lungu.
Mm.
It's because the law in your view has been offended.
Mm. I sleep comfortably, Ambassador.
Mm.
Even when I was banned, you know, it comes down to your faith.
Mm.
You know, when you're doing God's work and there is trouble, you simply say, Lord, that's your battle.
Yeah.
I've done my part. You deal with it.
Mm.
Now, the beauty is this. I was just getting messages of solidarity from all over the world.
Mm.
People speaking for me,
mm.
you know, and I sat there comfortably because I did no wrong. Okay? It's different if you're accused as a lawyer to say I've taken clients' money. That's different. I was fighting an issue of principle. First, the first thing that I did, first of all, after Mwanawasa, if I may backtrack a little bit, I never thought Zambians would elect another lawyer as president. So when President Edgar Lungu became president, I thought, wow. Okay? And
we skipped something.
Yes.
You said a lot of people in this country respect Mwanawasa, Levi Mwanawasa,
is
deemed as an anti-corruption president, one that brought national standards and values. Why do you have a negative view of him?
I disagree with first of all, what he did, because that corruption fight... Can you cut?
Thank you. Okay.
Why are you on the other side? Why are you defending Chiluba and she tells me of an incident where they have traveled somewhere with President Mwanawasa, and there was a story about me, and Mwanawasa went to her and said, through the newspaper at her, I said, see what your son-in-law is doing.
He's doing, yeah.
So she came and we had a conversation to say, leave these things alone. Leave Chiluba alone. You know, you still have kids to bring up.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, I've taken oath. I have to defend the Constitution and I have to defend the law. I have to do my part. This, for me, is not just a legal obligation. It is also a spiritual obligation. And whatever happens to my life, and I'm sure the big man upstairs knows what to do.
Mm.
But it came to pass. But I disagreed with the other point to note, Ambassador, is that I've never been on the side of the powerful.
Yeah.
I've always been on the side
of the weak.
We represented Kaunda, not when he was in State House, outside. Then we are acting for Chiluba when he was at his weakest. But the point I was making about President not commenting on cases was the president had already characterized Chiluba as a criminal before investigations were conducted.
Chiluba's right to innocence was taken away.
So all the investigations were about gathering evidence to prove that Chiluba is a criminal.
Yeah.
So the investigation, by virtue of that, those pronouncements, were already tainted. Then how do you come out and say, by the way, the president lied, there is no evidence of Chiluba's wrongdoing? So they had to look for it, and where necessary, I think in certain instances, it was manufactured. I can tell you, given everything that I've seen, if you ask me, do I believe Chiluba stole from the government? My answer would be a categorical no. Chiluba never dipped his fingers in government coffers. He never stole money from government. Never. I never saw it. And in fact, I did even challenge the prosecutors to say, you know what? I'm a man of integrity. I'd love to believe so. Show me where, you know, it reminds me of somebody, just a minor digression, where you hear a minister of finances, a minister of information say in response to the
Swedish ambassador
to say, show us evidence. You know, it's one thing to be corrupt. It's another thing to be also ignorant. It's a lethal combination.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? First, you can't say that because people that engage in corruption, they don't receive rubles or yuan as bribes. What do they receive? They receive dollars. They receive pounds. They receive
Zambian kwacha.
Don't worry about Zambian kwacha. But they don't even deal in those things.
Mm.
They receive dollars. They receive euros or pounds. Now tell me, who controls those currencies? So for you to have such a response, it means you are ignorant about how the global financial system works. These guys, when an ambassador says your government is corrupt, they know what they are talking about.
They've seen some funny transactions.
You are dealing in their currencies. They know. And in any case, when you steal money, where did they invest you know, it's like you telling Mobutu to the Belgium ambassador comes and tells Mobutu to say you are corrupt, and Mobutu says, show me the evidence.
You tell you we house it in our banks.
And also, the other point is that don't forget, these Europeans have a far more effective intelligence, better than our intelligence. So when they say you guys are corrupt, they know what they are talking about. They have the information, okay? So you can't, I mean, if you don't understand the global dynamics, keep quiet. And that is why before you engage in corruption, try to understand how the global financial system works.
Mm.
Once you understand it, you won't take bribes. You will not take government money, and you will not engage in corruption.
Mm.
Okay. So, but anyway, that was just a minor digression. But one of the things we learned, and I can categorically say, go on record, that I did not see any evidence pointing to the fact that Chiluba dipped into government funds.
Mm. Mm.
But the truth in the process gets buried because he's already convicted by President Marawasa.
In fact, there were two audits, one from Price Waterhouse and the other one from Grant Thornton, UK. They didn't even contract the local companies.
No.
That demonstrated that, in fact, there was over $8 million for Chiluba.
Funds from other sources.
Yes.
But the point is this. This is something that maybe we have to address. There is no law prohibiting or controlling what a president can receive in terms of gifts and so forth. Maybe that is what we need to address. But nothing stops a president, for example, from receiving $1 million from outside, and it doesn't need to, there's no obligation to disclose. But those are the laws that we, the loopholes we need to seal off. And that is where I have a problem with President Mwanawasa. He poisoned the world. All the investigations were about proving that Chiluba was.
They didn't want to demonstrate that the president had lied.
No.
And therefore they were not interested in the truth.
No, they were not interested in the truth. Mm. And that is why president should stay away from these investigations. Never comment. Allow these law enforcement agencies to do independent investigations. And then you get to see the truth. But also what is interesting, President Mwanawasa was in office for 8 years. If Chiluba was as corrupt as he was meant to look like, can you think of one thing? What reforms did Mwanawasa carry out to make sure that the subsequent governments are not corrupt?
Yeah.
I can't think of any.
Legally thin, nothing.
Legally nothing.
From the task force,
all the institutions were left and so forth. But there is a downside to what Mwanawasa did. Because what happened was all the civil servants were now being interrogated for things they did. And some of them were actually implicated by virtue of what they did. Because the government, somebody told me to say, to change a bulb in government, you do more paperwork possibly
than
the value
of
the bulb. That's the bureaucracy. So when money is moved from government, it involves a chain of people. So if you have to arrest, you have to arrest everybody involved. So a lot of people found themselves, it was selective.
Mm.
Because of what people saw, some of the civil servants, the technocrats, became now afraid to take decisions.
Mm.
The paralysis we see
now
is a legacy of Mwanawasa's presidency. Because they were now, they saw what happened to their friends. They said, hey, you might end up in jail as well.
Mm.
So most of the civil servants, most of the public institutions, people don't make decisions.
No. Okay. There's utter paralysis.
That's exactly the point. Mm. That is a legacy of Mwanawasa. Okay? That this is what people don't talk about. But most interestingly, we spent more money on investigating corruption than what was actually recovered.
Yeah, true. The numbers were terrible. Because we spent officially around £40 million. That's in excess of $60-70 million.
Yes.
What
and
was
how
the
much
return? How much did we recover?
That's exactly the point.
Yeah.
But that money was spent on proving what was a lie from the beginning.
And it didn't help with constitutional reforms, it didn't help with legal reforms.
Yeah. So those are the challenges that we face, and those are my misgivings about obviously.
State Council, many people don't know that you've overseen six governments. You've participated actively in the other presidents. You've raised truth to power. So they're very surprised. I think they take it that when you took this vehement opposition to President Edgar Lungu, they thought you were UPND. And therefore, as early as December 2021, President Hakainde Hichilema has just been in office 3 months, you raised your first voice, your first alarm, that this president might even be far worse than Edgar Lungu. I guess President Hakainde Hichilema must have been furious to hear that.
Yeah.
And to the people, they were shocked because they thought you were a supporter of President Hakainde Hichilema.
Mm.
What made you begin to raise that alarm that early?
Okay. Now, if I may just go back. When President Lungu, in all these things, I give him credit for one thing, the amendment of the Constitution in 2016. You know, again, we have to learn to give credit where it is due. Yes, he may have many faults. Yes, his governance was atrocious. Yes, He wrecked a bill of $15 billion during his reign. But in all those things, there is at least something positive that I see. The amendment of the Constitution in 2016. First, I may have to be honest with you. I never thought I was actually going to do it. Now, there were some of the killer provision was one which required you to get 50% plus one.
To be elected as president.
Be elected president.
An incumbent.
An incumbent. Mwanawasa failed to do that. Oh, first of all, Chiluba removed it in the 1991 constitution. No matter how popular he was, another, that was another thing altogether, yeah. Other than barring Kaunda. He also reduced his, he made sure that the threshold for his electability, for his election was very low. He was scared of 50 plus one.
Returned to first past the post.
Exactly, 96. Now you have Lungu. He amends the constitution to provide for 50 plus one.
Provides a debt for election.
I thought this man either is selfless or is just downright crazy. But I think that was the most selfless thing he ever did. Because there's another case we did on behalf of Lars, where before that, it was the president's right to set an election date.
Yes, yes.
So the president would actually play around, get himself ready. When he's ready, then he announces and catches the opposition by surprise. That is now sealed in the constitution. In fact, we can even predict 50 years from now when the next election, the day when the next election will take place. So that is a legacy for President Lungu, no matter whether his administration was right or wrong, but I gave him credit for that. But I saw danger signs when he started saying, I'm going for another term. Then he introduced Bill 10. I said, if it means dying for this cause, I will. Ambassador, it's very difficult for me.
Yeah.
I find it very difficult for me to keep quiet in the sense that I'm a very privileged person in the sense that I went to school, studied law, and I taught for 20 years.
Yeah. At the University of Zambia.
At the University of Zambia. I taught public law, which is a combination of administrative law and constitutional law. And I stood in front of students and preached about the constitutional values, democratic values. How do I, in good conscience, keep quiet when I see these principles and values being violated?
Mm-hmm.
Then I become a hypocrite. Then whatever I was teaching students things I did not believe in. That I have a problem with. So when I saw Bill 10, I simply said, this is a non-starter. That Bill 10 was designed to undo whatever progress he had made in 2016. Because I think, as usual, like every other president, became scared of, because by 2020, President Lungu's last election was the 2016 election. It was done. And I told him, you have a good legacy. You are the first president in the history of the country to reduce the powers of the president. Mwanawasa fumbled. RRB fumbled. They retained the Chiluba 1996 constitution. So when I became, and I started, and because of that, I was a keen watcher of what he was doing. The first sign was the composition of the Constitutional Court judges.
Yeah.
And I simply said, you know, you can have a wonderful institution. Institution is people.
Yeah.
You put in the rubbish.
They bring life to
yes,
the institution.
You put in rubbish, you get rubbish.
Mm.
You put in good people, you get good results. And most of those people, I knew them. They did not in any way, it was nothing personal.
True.
They did not just qualify because the Constitution went further to stipulate the requirements for appointment as a constitutional court. That was the first alarm I raised with President Lungu. And I wrote him before they were even confirmed. And as usual, as presidents, I don't know whether they live in a bubble or they behave as though they know everything. And there was no response. And I kept on talking about, the point is this, Ambassador, your judiciary, you can sacrifice all institutions, but never sacrifice your judiciary. You elect a president every 5 years. You can choose to throw him out. You elect your MPs every 5 years. You can choose to throw them out. But your judges
are literally there for life.
They are there for life.
At least pensionable life.
At least they'll go there. The earliest you can leave is 65, the last period. That was another achievement. One of the cases we did. We sued Chief Justice Sakala and Chitenge when we had a system whereby once you reach your retirement age, you go and cut a deal with the president.
And they give you some contract.
Yes. We said, no, this is illegal. This can't happen. This is a deal. I said, this undermines the credibility of the judiciary. We went to court. We lost. But in 2016, when the Constitution was amended, that was removed. Early retirement as a judge, 65. Final retirement, if you still have the strength, you go up to 70. 70, you pack up your bags. There was nothing like you getting an extension. That was progress. So even though we lose cases, people do listen. Yeah. At the appropriate time, they incorporate these things into the law. So when Bill 10 came, Ambassador, I just put my life on the line.
Yeah.
And I remained vocal, and even when... I've never been partisan. I've only belonged to one political party, which was UNIP. And that was also for the benefit of entering the market and getting on UBZ bus.
Yeah.
That is how brutal.
Because it was a requirement.
It was a requirement. You needed to show your card. Yeah. Your card.
To jump on a bus.
To jump on a bus. You needed that card. And UNIP was a mass party. Everybody belonged to UNIP. You're a youth. There was youth wing. Women's wing, and everybody was a member of UNIP. So that was the only party, but I joined it not out of choice, but it was
out of cohesion.
Out of that. So I have never been partisan. The only thing that I've always been true to is the Constitution. So when that was built...
So in national causes, You love your values and principles sometimes coincide with political players, and they might assume you're their member.
That was the assumption which UPND made, okay? Because if anything, I think they rode on me instead of the other way around. They saw that it was a popular cause, and all what happened was that I think our principles and values just aligned. Not that I became a UPND. I've never been a UPND. Member, I've never belonged to any political party. And that is why, for example, if I may backtrack a little bit, in 2001, when President Sata left MMD.
Yeah.
PF,
prior to elections, yes.
Yes. The first place Mr. Sata came to was to our chambers. The day when he resigned from MMD. And he came and told us to say he was forming his own political party. We worked with him. But once he got into office, we distanced ourselves from him. We only said, Mr. President, we're not politicians. We're not part of you. But if there is something for you, you want us to do, we will help you for the good of the country. We stayed away from President Saad. Edgar Lungu, we were sitting together when we were doing those Chiluba cases.
Yeah.
We're sitting. We opened those Chikwa courts, by the way.
Yes.
So when he became president, I did extend my hand to say...
Yeah, because President Lungu was representing Stella Chibanda.
Stella Chibanda, yes. And we're representing President...
And to be on the bench.
That's right. We sat together. I did offer, tried to reach out to him to say, okay, to offer him my support. I never succeeded, which was fine. I've always tried to stay away from politicians. So when Bill 10 came, it was a popular cause. So obviously, I think UPND saw that as an opportunity to boost their popularity. And it worked. Okay, it worked. But I remember one of the politicians, whom I shall not name, came to me and said, let's go and see HH. And I said, why? I says, you know, you need funding for what you're doing. Mm. And I said, I don't need funding. I'm funding this butane case for myself. I spent, Ambassador, 6 months working on that butane petition. Yeah. Day after day, day after day, I didn't dedicate any other work to make extra income. I did that. I said, no, I don't need money from a church in order to do this course. Yeah. I will fund it.
Yeah.
I have the means and have the... So even when we are doing all those cases, there was, I think, an incident where I think I was condemned to pay costs.
Yes, yes, I remember.
And there was a groundswell of mobilization. People said, tell us the account where we want to put in the money.
Mm.
You know, I said, no, take it. This is politics these guys are playing. There's no way you can get $1 million, $1 million kwacha in cost.
Yeah.
So that was the experience with President Lungu. And I tried to warn President Lungu, don't go for a third term. Protect your legacy. You have already done so much. You have given us a good constitution, although it's not a full constitution, but at least what you have put in a strong foundation for any viable government. So when he stood up now to amend through Bill 10, that's when I just lost it, and I said, no, this can't be allowed. But that the outcome of that shows you that even when it tells you the value of democracy, as usual, the judiciary backed, they betrayed us, the petition failed. Again, I didn't, not that I expected to win, but I used the petition as an educational tool to highlight to the people the dangers of Bill 10. That was basically the strategy.
I think your point has been, I've heard you recently, because the new Minister of Justice, Mulambe Haimbe, as soon as he came into office, he says we need to amend the Constitution. And he's been preaching the Constitution. Even your opposition to Bill 10 was, allow this Constitution to breathe. It's a living document. Allow it to live, then we can identify the faults.
Yes.
But before it even works, you are saying it has problems.
Mm.
Just explain that thought.
When I tried to reach out to President Lungu privately, that did not succeed. Then I decided to do through open letter to the president.
Yes.
Yeah, one of them was over the judges, and then the second letter was when he was now talking about third term. And I warned him. And my warning to him was, Mr. President, I don't trust you, and I don't trust the institutions, but I trust the people. You know? And it came to pass. So, Ambassador, I don't fear politicians. I don't fear state institutions. I fear the people. I have greater respect for the people of Zambia. Because those are the people that have the real power. Once they have, and they have shown it through the struggle for independence, the fight against one party.
I saw the struggles you went through when you were, and the pressure when you were defending Dr. Chiluba. I think the next kind of massive pressure against you was during this period.
Yes.
You were objecting to Bill 10 and others.
Yes.
Even your practice, you know, was threatened. How do you cope? Because people would fear for your lives, would fear for the life of your family. How do you cope?
Faith, Ambassador. I sleep comfortably.
Yeah.
You know, when you're doing God's work, you know, and also remember, one of the things I'll tell you, one of the most overwhelming experiences I've ever had in my entire career was the day I argued the case, Lungu's eligibility.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt like, you know what, my life on earth, you know, it's like where you could say,
I've done my part.
So the issue for me was not about winning that case, but was arguing that case. And I came to understand, I think in a way, in a strange way, why I was born,
mm-hmm.
why my life took the turns it did, why I ended up being a lawyer, why I ended up focusing in constitutional law and administrative law. And I think all the pieces came together when I argued the Lungu's eligibility case. Butane was just one, but Lungu's eligibility case was like, I felt like I'd done my assignment. If so I was you, to you, die you, at that time, I was going to die a very happy man. It's like I've done my race and I have done all what I was meant to do here on earth. It was not up to other people to do that.
In fact, that's what elicits my second question. You walked the country in that case.
Yes.
And the judiciary said President Lungu was eligible.
Yes.
So then people hear you in 2022, you are saying actually Lungu is eligible to stand.
Yes.
And he should be allowed to stand.
Yes.
So people see a contradiction. Just explain that.
There is no contradiction. I went to court, right? Now, if you look at the outcome, who is the loser in that eligibility case? The loser is the judiciary. Because people did not believe in the judiciary. They said, oh, you think he's eligible? We will decide who is truly eligible. Okay? But that is how a democratic system works. You don't only have to accept results in your favor. No. We have institutions, which is the court. My job when I go to court is to present my case to the best of my ability. And I'm also hoping that the judges will also do their jobs to the best of their abilities. Now, in this case, they fumbled. They construed the Constitution in a manner to accommodate President Lungu, which they shouldn't have. But that is the law. We respect that. You know, we have to learn to accept the outcome of the court's decision, whether we like it or not, because the power to decide what the law is vested in the courts, not in me. So we had two sides to that eligibility debate. There was one side that said Lungu qualifies, and there's the other side which said Lungu doesn't qualify. At the end of the day, we went before the court, and the court decided to say, I was wrong. The other side was right. Lungu is eligible. That is how he stood.
The funny part is now the same constitutional court is being asked to review their earlier position.
Yes.
What are your feelings around that?
Well, the very fact that they have allowed the case to go on is an act of lawlessness. The right course of action should have been, we have already decided on this issue, we will live with this decision, good or bad, is our decision. This matter is closed. Because there's a concept that we say, res judicata, matters have been decided. Because there has to be an end to litigation. Litigation can't
and
be
closed. That
you close, you live with it.
And their judgment became law.
It's law. Now, the only time you can reopen a case is if there is new material, new evidence, and so forth. Okay? I would be very surprised if I thought the court was to say now he's not eligible. If he was eligible in 2021,
two years ago,
how can he not be eligible now? Because what has transpired? And how can the only way that would be possible is for the court to say, we were wrong. Now, how can they do that? How are you wrong? You are wrong because presidents have changed or what? Mm. Justice should never take the color of who is in state house. What is lawful under President Lungu should also be lawful under President HH. So it doesn't matter. That is why, you know, people sometimes, you see, when you go to court, you find there is that statute of Lady Justice.
Yes.
It's covered.
Yes, she's blind.
She's blind.
Why is she blind?
It is symbol. Justice is blind. It doesn't care who you are. You are rich, powerful, want, it doesn't matter. It looks at you equally. There's no justice for the rich. There's no justice for the poor. We are all equal before the law. That is the implication of that. But if, let's say, the judiciary does that, then it will have killed itself. It's already in a coma. Okay, and then now it's like, if whichever way they decide, I think we just pull out the plug from...
He's on life support.
Life support. We just pull out the plug now and just get rid of it. That is what the implication would be, you know. So that is where I come from, Ambassador. I have always avoided, even throughout the reign of President Sata. I think when Sata was in office, we only saw him once or twice, two or three times, and that was at his instigation. He called us, we went in, talked about one or two things, then thereafter, and obviously towards the end, he was sick, and we couldn't, but we never entered to his government.
We will conclude with your assessment of President Nagainde Hichilema. He comes at a novel time, 2021. Democracy is deemed to be threatened. He comes on a popular vote. There's popular participation across the country. And he is presented as a Democrat that will resolve our various crises that we have. And you were among the earliest critics of his rule and his governance. Let's take that journey.
Yes. You know, when you have privilege as I am, to have the experiences that I've had, and having interacted with former presidents, and having studied the history, you can see the telltale signs. And it's always good to warn the people, because of what I know, it would be wrong to keep quiet. I'll tell you, one of the first things that I think people often ignore is that I don't think at all one of the biggest mistakes President HH has made, I don't think at all he understands the implication of the election of 2021. In some misguided way, he thinks it's a reflection of his popularity. No. I would put it bluntly. In that election, Zambian people used him to get rid of Lungu. That's the way it has to be seen.
It's not because he's an economist. It's not because he can fix it.
No.
It's not because he's fluent or he speaks better.
No, no. That's my reading. It's a situation whereby the election was a revolt against President Lungu. Don't forget, there are two things. There is PF and there is Lungu. It was not a rejection of PF. It was a rejection of Lungu. Okay, because people just did not like his style of governance, and they did not want to give him another 5 years. People, citizens, are smarter than, they are very smart. Politicians always underestimate the voters. The election result, when I look at it, it's like, you know, remember I say, it's individual people voting in secret.
Yeah.
But the outcome, this is the way I perceive it, it's like manufactured by some supernatural force. Okay? Let me explain by that. People drew experience from the 2016 election, whereby President Lungu won by a razor thin number, which was 0.3%. 0.3 was simply 13,000 votes. Now, when you are talking about 0.3, 0.2, 0.6, 0.3 in other jurisdictions would go for automatic rerun, because that is within the margin of error. But when you want to remove a president, you don't want to remove him with such kind of margin. It has to be overwhelming, and people knew that. I already knew that PF was going to lose when there was a decision to re-register the voters.
Why?
Ambassador, I went to the centers to register.
As a voter?
As a voter. Three separate nights, I couldn't. The number of people that I saw were overwhelming. On one of those days, I went at midnight and still found a queue.
You knew this is a change vote. It's not a vote for the incumbent.
No. When people are happy with the incumbent, they don't bother to vote globally. Like they'll tell you, if things are okay, why do you want to change
them?
Don't
fix it, yeah.
So I knew Lungu was on his way out. So even so it was a combination of factors. The problem is that I think politicians live in a bubble. And if Lungu had seen that, he'd have possibly toned down and it would have been moderated. I have no doubt in my mind, if PF had removed President Lungu, put in somebody there, PF would still be in power today. That vote was a revolt against President Lungu. So I already knew from the voter turnout that Lungu is gone. On the election day, you know, you see, and that's the beauty of democracy. Allow people to talk. When they keep quiet, you should be worried because you don't know what they are thinking. Because they'll just come and thump you on election day. And that is the same mood that I see right now, where people have stopped talking. They're just waiting for 2026. I was very optimistic about the outcome of the election. In the sense that, like I've said, when everything is okay in the country, normally the voter turnout tends to be slow, to be very low. But in this case, the voter turnout, the number of new voters, if you recall, there was already this mistrust by some NGOs to say, no, the decision to cancel the earlier register and re-register voters was meant to eliminate some people from voting. But what it turned out was that even more voters went on the
new ballot, new
registered voters. So when I think the numbers must have jumped, we may have had about 6 million or so.
About seven.
7 million. I think maybe five. There was an increase of about 2 million new voters, and that was already a very bad sign for the incumbent. Perhaps there is something that I need to mention about the fact that, you know, democracies are not easy, and democracies need to be fought for, need to be protected. And what amazes me sometimes is the naivety of us Zambians to think that we can have democracy and it can thrive without a price. There's a price to democracy. There is even a possibility of people losing their lives in defense of democracy. I haven't shared this. I've already painted a very positive picture as though everything was okay throughout my struggle. But there was one particular incident when I decided, after I embarked on to fight Bill 10, and these are invariably lonely battles. You can't get people on board. You have to make a decision yourself, purely born out of your own conviction. And if people will join you, well and good. And then also, when I decided, for me, the most challenging case was when I decided to challenge the eligibility of President Lungu. And it was that time that, yeah, I'm only human. At the end of the day, I was also I had a bit of concerns. I have to tell you, up to that point, I had not prepared my will. Yes.
Did you feel that the battle was so onerous, so risky, that you faced death?
Yes, because, but you see, the point is this: when you embark on a fight like the one I was on, you have to prepare for the worst. If it doesn't come, well and good, but if it comes, you're ready for it. We, as Zambians, were normally suspicious about preparing wills.
Yeah.
We always think that when you prepare a will, you are dying tomorrow. So that time I said, no, let me put my affairs in order. I settled my will. You know, every man has his weakness, and we all have two weaknesses. Our wives and our children. If you're involved in a struggle, they touch your wife. If you recall the day when Regina Chilu was arrested, that was the day I saw, I think that was the day when Munawasa managed to break.
Dr. Chiluba, yes, I remember that day.
Yes, because
very clearly, he had been strong.
Yes,
every time we went to police stations, you know, relatives were weeping. The day he was arrested, people were kissing, but he would encourage all of us.
That's right.
But the day they arrested his wife,
that's right,
I saw a broken man.
Yes, and his point was, what kind of a man am I? If I can't even protect my wife. So if you want to see a man's weakness, touch his family. And that was the thing that I was in that situation. But fortunately for me, my first marriage had ended. And I only had my current second wife, but at that time we're not yet married, and my kids. And I remember having a chat with my firstborn son. He said, son, there is this possibility.
Wow.
In all my struggles, that was the only time I shed tears. I could have walked away, but we need to rise to the level where we love this country enough to die for. I spoke to my firstborn son and I said to him, son, there is this possibility. Anything can happen. And if it happens, I have three boys. And I said, you may have to step forward and take care of your siblings. And you know our children, they're not as hard as we are. And I think the poor boy didn't take it
well.
He didn't take it very well. And it's like you are saying goodbyes. And I said, no, it's not that. It may not happen. If it doesn't happen, well and good. The second point was I approached my current wife. She's Italian. And I said, you know, this is not your country. But she was born here, grew up here, and she hasn't known any other country other than Zambia. And I said, this is a country. This is a struggle for my country. I've signed up for this, but you didn't. So I think if I'll understand if you decide to walk away. And she said, no, I'm not going anywhere. And I said, well, I didn't want to assume that you are staying, because what I'm embarking on is a very, I'm on a rough road. Anything can happen. And she said, no, staying. I think if there was a moment where I wavered in my conviction, it was that moment. And to realize that, yes, because those are the two major weaknesses, your children and your wife.
Yeah.
I had that sealed off, I had my will in place. I was now ready. That's how I did those cases with a clear conscience. Although I had my faith, but again, you still prepare. Mm. You know, sometimes people misunderstand faith.
So, State Council, the stakes were that high. The threats were that intense.
Yes. Yes. You know, because anything can happen. Because, you see, you are dealing with a system that was Lungu's. Maybe its level of brutality may have been exaggerated, but you have to prepare. Because remember, when you want to change a system, they're vested interests. Whereas you're fighting democracy, to them, democracy threatens.
They're taking all their jobs.
Or their jobs, their interests.
All their opportunities.
Yes, all their opportunities. And one of the things I realized was that sometimes these things are done without even the president knowing. And I also prepared myself for anything. I mean, I had seen a former president, Kenneth Kaunda, being searched for 8 hours, accused of having stolen books from State House. This was a man we used to sing, Kumulule Sapanshi Kaunda. He was reduced to that level. I saw the first president accused of having, the story in MMD was that Kaunda was a very wealthy man.
And he had stolen $4 billion.
Yes, he had properties in Romania, hotels all over the world, and we believed it. But later on we learned that he was just a poor man who didn't even have a single property in his name. And to this day, we've only come to learn about that, but the damage was already done. And I saw a former president declared stateless after being in power. Later on, I saw a former president dragged to court for 7 years, accused of money he never stole. Who am I? If they wanted to eliminate, they could easily have eliminated. I was not naive about the brutality of government and what they can do, what they can manufacture. So I prepared myself. That was the background I had. If Kaunda can be brought down, Chiluba can be brought down. I was nothing. For me, they can just smash like a fly. But I had to prepare. But it turned out things worked out. I've said a lot of things about President Lungu, and then we get a picture.
Are there good parts about him?
Of course,
we go to President Nagai.
There is. there is nobody who is completely bad. You know, there are some good things that was done under him, and I give him credit for the constitution that we have currently as amended. We could have completed that exercise by having the Bill of Rights. But UPND campaigned very strongly against the referendum, largely because they didn't just, it was more out of ignorance than anything else. But that is, they convinced the people not to vote for the bill. That's democracy. You work with numbers. For me, if I was to give President Lungu credit, it is in that respect. There is also something else that we don't talk about.
Yeah.
If somebody was really honest, if let's say we are to talk about Lusaka, I think the greatest development in terms of buildings opening up new areas in Lusaka, they have happened during the 10 years of PF. You see, you know, you can now get lost in Lusaka.
Yes, you can. Yes, you can.
Okay. Mm. Before that, you couldn't get lost in Lusaka. You know, I could actually drive in Lusaka with my eyes closed. I knew where the road where it led and everything else. But in the last 10 years, we have seen massive transformation of Lusaka. Mm-hmm. And that was all been under PF. And if you and all what they had to do was just put a road and Zesco, and then people just came and doubt. So we have had new areas transformed. And I think that is something worthwhile to acknowledge, rather than just saying that all these people are just busy stealing and everything else. But of course, the biggest problem is the cost of those projects. They were necessary projects, but invariably we differed over, there were questionable expenses to do with that. So I think in my view, I think those are the two areas that I would. Mm. But I think the most outstanding one would be the Constitution, because I think for me that was a selfless act. When you put in place the Constitution, that works against you.
Should it be amended?
Ambassador, the Constitution should not be amended for two reasons. First, there's no Constitution is ever perfect. It's ever perfect. None. There is no constitution in the world that is perfect. So constitution has its own challenges. And that is why you have a special court, the constitutional court, to iron out all the imperfections through the process of interpretation. Now, if you decide to amend, it has to be a product of consultation. I have heard this crazy idea by this government where they're saying, we want to amend the non-contentious clauses.
Mm.
Now, it is crazy. It is completely irresponsible. You don't do that with the Constitution. Now, first of all, when you say non-contentious, non-contentious to according to who? What is your reference point?
Mm.
If you ask me, I have my own clauses that I may not like, but that's not the basis of the Constitution. Once the Constitution is in place, whether you like it, you don't like it, it is binding. There's a second reason why this government does not have legitimate grounds to amend the Constitution. The same reasons we advanced against Bill 10, those
they've
reasons
remained valid.
They've remained valid for any subsequent amendments. The reason is the Constitution as we have it is a product it is a bipartisan product. If you recall, in 2016, PF did not have the two-thirds majority to amend the Constitution on its own. So for the amendment to go through, it needed the support of UPND. So both PF and UPND birthed the Constitution as it is.
So the rare times in our country when you have that kind of consensus.
We've never had that. 1996 was a lone job that was done by Chiluba.
Using the bully of numbers.
Yes, 1991, that was again a Kaunda product where Kaunda was forced to compromise. 1991, Chiluba had more than two-thirds. 1996, Chiluba had more than two-thirds of the seats in the National Assembly. It didn't need the concurrence of UNIP at that time, because UNIP was insignificant by that time. But 2016, we had behind us nearly what 20 years of experience with the Constitution as amended in 1996. 20 years is a long period, enough for you to be able to review and see the imperfections in the Constitution and try and change them. But this Constitution is just, it's not even 10 years old as amended. It is a bipartisan product. Now, there is no reason to change it, because there is no clause in that Constitution which did not have the support of UPND. Clauses that UPND did not agree with were not included. For example, there was a provision where they agreed that the president should be able to appoint ministers from outside parliament.
It was rejected
by both PF and UPND. So it is a bipartisan product. And that is why I'm opposed to that. There is no reason. And not only that, the Constitution has proven itself. You know, it is actually largely responsible for PF remaining intact as an opposition party.
How come?
Very simple. Before 2016, I think you remember this, when President Mwanawasa was basically a minority president, what did he do? He started sponsoring defections, poaching UPND members. I think if you remember, the first casualty was Dr. Sipula Kabanje, who was, I think, UPND. He resigned from UPND, and he was sponsored. He crossed over to MMD and sponsored, and he won. So there was a lot of crossing where you can now resign your position as a UPND, as an MP, and then you go and stand on the opposition, on the other party's ticket. Now, there is no incentive for you to do that. You cause that kind of by-election.
It means you will not participate.
You will not participate. So that is why PF has remained intact. And that is how they ended up stealing those two seats of
Kwacha
and Kabushi. You know, I mean, for me, that was a pure theft. Where you simply say, I have the power and I'm taking this. So this constitution has proven itself. It has also largely been responsible for ensuring that President Edgar Lungu continues to enjoy his immunity. Because right now, even if you presented a motion to lift his immunity, you don't have the numbers. And two, unless some members of PF decide to cross over. But that is not guaranteed. But also, there are many other provisions in the Constitution, for example, which have not been actuated. They have not been activated. So it is premature to know that it is performing or not performing, because it's not yet complete. Okay? For example, last week we were talking about the issue of the way the local government system is run. People do not even understand that we have a three-tier system where you have your central government, provincial government, and local government. People still don't know that, and even those in government, they don't even understand it. They have not given it life. So we need to fully implement it, see how it's going to work. You know, it's like you have a car which has some parts missing. There is no way you can determine that the performance of this car is okay, it's not okay. No, it's only when it is completely put together.
And you put it on the road.
You put it on the road. Then you see the performance to say, okay, we need to change it, we need to change it. That constitution is not yet complete because we have not activated some of the provisions. So that is, those are some of the reasons why I would oppose. Because, for example, if somebody wants to change, what would be the reason? You have to make a case. What is your reason? Or you can't just say, well, there is lacuna. I mean, there is this word even which people use, lacunas. First of all, there is nothing like lacunas. You know, that's not, the word doesn't exist. They are no blank. When you say lacuna, it's a blank. It's like saying there are blanks in the Bible. We take the Bible as it is. We don't take it as it should be. You also take the Constitution as it is. You know, because the moment you allow a person to start questioning the Constitution, where are you going to end up? You know, so there is absolutely no reason. We have to see it happen. And then there is also something else that people don't understand. The Constitution is as good as the people. If there have been imperfections, there have been imperfections that have come about because we have put wrong people in these constitutional offices. So you can have the best constitution, but a best written document. But if you give it to the wrong people to run with it, it will not perform as expected. You know, we have always had this struggle, for example, to do with the constitutional court. There are problems with that court, and there continue to be problems with that court. I'll give you an example, for instance. I may not get my numbers right, but I'll try. I think President Lungu appointed 9 judges. Two of those judges, I think maybe is it 9 or 8, but I don't know the number. But two of those judges have died. I think that reduced the number to about, I think, five or six or so. Now, what does President Chichilema do? He comes into office. What does he do? He appoints his own, I think, four or five new judges. He doesn't pause for a moment to say, okay, why am I doing this? The caseload of that court did not justify the appointment of extra judges. Because that
beyond
court,
seven, what was the total number? Is it seven or nine?
I think there must have been, there must have remained maybe six or seven judges. But the point is this, we cannot justify the appointment of the additional five judges because there is no work. Okay? Because in a year, unless maybe in an election year, on average in a year, that we have not more than 50 cases filed.
So the bulk of the current caseload really lies on the weight of either magistrates or high court judges.
It's mostly high court judges. Like we are talking about the figures. Last year, for instance, we filed something like 2,300 cases divided amongst 12 judges.
Wow.
These are things we don't talk about.
Even if they are superhuman.
Even if they are superhuman, there is no way they can perform. So we are lying to people that we are delivering justice. There's no justice being delivered because the caseload is just unmanageable. That is for this year, for last year. Now we have started another year. Yeah. We're going to have another. So at the end of the day, the system will collapse. Now, these judges are poorly paid. You're talking about a judge taking home something like $1,000, even if you're paying them $2,000. But that same judge also wants to take his children to a private school.
It's called a judge.
Yes, yes.
Society has so many expectations.
Exactly. So what do you expect? You know, so the system is broken. So in this case of the Constitutional Court, you have judges who are doing less work, being paid more money. Then you have judges doing more work and receiving less money. That is just a dysfunction which needs to be addressed. But at the end of the day, when there is failure to deliver delays in cases, a failure to deliver justice, it is not a failure of the Constitution. It is the failure of human beings. And in addition to that, judges are not adequately funded. The funding is a struggle. I haven't seen the current budget allocation, but I think last year we're talking about, I don't know whether it's less than 1% or 2%. That is what
Very minimal.
You can't. You see, if you value, at the end of the day, I think what we need to do is to have a conversation. Yes, we know that we are stressed financially, but there are certain key institutions that should be given priority. And one of those institutions I'd advocate for is the judiciary. You can start funding to other organs, but I think we need to give priority to the judiciary.
Sure. Yeah.
Yes, because once that collapses, I'm always a firm believer that, you know what, it's okay to have a corrupt president. A country can survive with a corrupt president, corrupt MPs, but once your judges are also corrupt, you're finished as a country.
So instead, collapses.
Yes, yeah. So coming to, that is what I would say, it wasn't a complete disaster, obviously, as like they say, even a broken clock gets it right once or twice.
A day.
Yeah, so, yeah.
This now brings me to your review on President Hakainde Hichilema.
Mm-hmm.
He's won. It's even a personal triumph to you, because this journey, as you've demonstrated, the personal risks you took, and many Zambians benefited in President Hakainde Hichilema. He's been in office for 2.5 years. Give me a review.
Well, there's somebody who called me. He's, I think, much older than me. Could be in his 70s. He's been a follower of Zambian politics. And he said, you know what? I'm very upset with myself. I said, but why? I said, I got duped. Duped by who? I said, by this man in State House. And I said, you know, I'm so upset with myself because I didn't think that at my age, I would be lied to. Because this is not the man we voted for.
Oh, that's a serious indictment.
And I said, my brother, if it's any consolation, you're not the only one. We are many. You see, the expectations were very high. Because personally, I never thought there would be things could get worse than they were under PF. Because PF was in decline. And success, a person in the position of President Hichilema would be just arresting the decline is already a success. You know, it's like you have a truck without brakes, sliding, right? So you are successful in just stopping that truck.
Before you attend to the brakes.
Before you even, your primary objective is simply to arrest it, not to end up in a river, in a ditch. You've already succeeded. That is all what was expected. But we arrested the momentum. But what has happened? It's like that was just a temporary situation. And the truck is let loose. This is just my personal view, which is that I did not expect, if we are to evaluate the two presidents, Lungu and Hichilema, I would forgive Lungu for his shortcomings, but I wouldn't forgive Hichilema for his shortcomings. The reason is, Lungu was an accident. Lungu never planned to be president. Death occurred, and he found himself in a certain place. I think if you remember, the Lungu was described as umupiani.
True.
Okay? He was in the right place at the right time. He never aspired. I knew Lungu when we were together, of course. I don't think other people would say Lungu had presidential ambitions before that time. But Hichilema is different. He's been crying for this office for 15 years. Now, having fought for it, the expectation is that given a chance, you know what to do. But I've said to somebody close to him, and I said, you know, failure for President Hichilema is a choice. President Hichilema has chosen to fail. Let me explain what I mean by that. This country's next year will be 60 years. So, Hichilema and the rest of us lived under 27 years under count. By the time Kaunda was being removed, we were mature enough. We understood the dynamics, what was happening. Now, this system was one extreme system. It was a one-party state where government controlled everything. You know, I remember those of us who grew up on the copper belt, the miners, they used to get an allowance called Indalama Shamusana.
Yeah.
If you remember, I don't know whether you understand what it means.
Yes, they were encouraging more population.
That's right. So for every child, if you're working for ZCCM, they gave you an allowance. So literally, government even entered your bedroom, you know, and you produce, first of all, when I tell this to people, they can't believe it. ZCCM used to give nappies to newly born babies. You went to a minor hospital. In fact, as parents, you didn't even need to buy anything. I think even baby milk was given. And then after you finish, your child reaches level to go to nursery. You went to nursery, done by ZCCM, went to school by ZCCM. Everything was literally provided. But that system was clearly unsustainable. It worked up to a certain point. Its failure was the inability to reform, to adapt. It was good up, it was justifiable up to a certain from the beginning, but when it grew, it failed to adapt and it collapsed. Then we chucked out that system and brought in another system in 91, which we are now calling a free market, liberal democracy, and so forth. I think if you remember, that was a slogan by President Chiluba. Government has no business in business.
Business, true.
So, which meant privatize. So, what happened? This was now another extreme. One situation whereby government controlled all the businesses, and the other extreme, government had absolutely abandoned. Nothing to do with business. But both systems failed. One party state saddled us with a debt of $7 billion. That free market system, liberal democracy, over 30 years shared between, which comprised 20 years of MMD, 10 years of PF, that system also collapsed. By 2021, we ended up with a debt of $15 billion. If you look at per capita, debt per capita, it's exactly the same. We ended up at the same position. We're in the same position
we were in 1991.
So I have said, with these two experiences, Hichilema's, the experiences from both systems, in my views, work was very easy. Is to be able to collect what worked in 30 years here, what worked here, package it. Because the country has never taken a center position. What needed for the country was to try the center, which has never been tried before, where you have a combination of what worked there and what worked this side, and then package something. He has not done that. And I think I was saying that the situations are similar, but there is one radical difference. Hichilema is not Chiluba. There's a radical difference. And one of the things stands out is that between the two men, I think Chiluba understood government, whereas HH doesn't understand government and how government works. Chiluba understood government, and Chiluba understood
the people.
He understood the people. He understood the government. He understood the challenges. And I think he was more truthful and more honest to the people. And that is why throughout he was able to carry out these brutal, brutal, brutal reforms. And nobody ever rioted. The reason was he was truthful from the beginning. He never fabricated reality. He never manufactured reality. He told the people openly things are bad. Are you ready to make sacrifices? And people said, yes, we are ready. And he put it as it was. Mm. In fact, Chiluba, I would say, under-promised and over-delivered. Now, what we have is a situation where you over-promise and delivery zero. But that is not even the major problem. The major problem is that we all know there is a difference between campaigning and governing. When you are campaigning, you make all manner of promises. Mm. But when you're in government, it's different. Now reality dawns. But that is not even the problem. I think Hichilema's task was also quite easy. What was required was to go back to the people. I've been in office 3 months, 6 months. I have seen the situation. I promised free education. I promised this. I promised this. I promised this. The reality is we can't achieve those things. Why? The truth is we have no money as a country. Zambians would understand. But he has not done that. Instead, he's manufacturing success. He's manufacturing reality. But that can only take you so far. So
why has he failed?
I don't have an answer to that. And I keep asking myself. And I said, listen, you know, you can only do what you can with the resources available. But I think his inability, to, if I was to guess, I think what he has just failed is to go back to the people and explain and go back, to be seen as going back to, against his word. No, it's not. It's about being realistic. Nobody, first of all, if I may backtrack, nobody expected HH to solve Zambia's problems in 5 years. Oh, nobody expected that. Okay? But the expectation was he was going to start to put the country on the right footing towards the realization of those goals. But what is there is that you don't see that. There are a few major mistakes he's made, which makes him pale in comparison to Chiluba. Chiluba, I think, understood where power was. He had the power. Mm. And he understood the role of his ministers, that they work for him. And if you look at the first cabinet of President Chiluba, it had the best brains in the country. And they made decisions that ultimately made Chiluba look very good. The first sign of danger for me with HH was, first of all, the period it took to put together cabinet. I think it took him almost 3 months.
Yes.
Now, unless you're an accidental president, but if you have gone for an election, like everybody else, they say, when you go for an election, you prepare two speeches, concession speech and a victory speech, because you don't know, you're in the hands of the people. With a victory speech, you also have a tentative cabinet. Now, to have taken that long, that already meant trouble. Nobody goes to school to train as president. Nobody goes to school to train as minister. So when you go there, is try and error. But the most important thing is to try, not to leave that vacuum. And I think somebody did ask me, what do you think of HH? And I said, well, let's wait for his cabinet first. When the names came out, they were a completely uninspiring lot. And today people blame them for the government shortcomings. You don't blame the ministers. You blame the president because the backstops with them.
He's the one that picked them up.
Yes. Our system of government is such that when that's why all the parliament is dissolved, everybody else, they go. You have to reconstitute the government. So you have no baggage. So you're going there to put your own structures so that you don't have an excuse. And even the kind of excuses I heard one time somebody was saying, well, don't think with the election of HH, then corruption ended. I said, listen, you're now in charge. Mm-hmm. If there is corruption, that is your problem. Mm-hmm. Okay, you should have put in place measures to address those challenges. So from that perspective, there was a serious error. Look at the composition. The composition is completely uninspiring. And also, you don't get a clear policy direction. Maybe you have. I haven't heard anything. Bottom line, from my perspective, I would say the president has no vision for this country. That is the bottom line. And, you know, when you have a vision, even if it is a bad vision, it's better than no vision at all. Look at Kaunda, for instance.
In fact, I was coming to that point. Over this program, during this program, you've touched on every president. What are your ratings? Who do you think is, we've had seven presidents.
Yes.
Is the best president Zambia has ever had? And who do you think in your ranking is the worst president?
I would... we may have to exclude those that like President Sata, because he never finished his term, and also President Banda. Manawasa was in there for 8 years. Banda was only a
3 years,
a short period of time. But in historical context, this is how I would put it. I would put President Lungu and President Kaunda in the same basket. I would put President Hichilema and Frederick Chiluba in the same basket. Let me explain about what I mean by that. Kaunda inherited a good economy. By 1991, that economy was trashed. So, but at least it did that. Over 27 years, we had a debt of 27 billion.
Of 7 billion.
Then you have President Lungu, who inherits quite a good economy, very low external debt. I think when Arabi left power, the external debt was less than $2 billion.
Michael Sata took over $1.5 billion.
But when President Lungu was leaving office, and then we have to be realistic, we cannot, but numbers are there. And I always believe that you can't build a country through lies. You have to be honest about it. But at the time, 10 years, we had borrowed externally, well in excess of $15 billion. So, get a good economy. And by the way, the exchange rate when President Sata took over, I think on a rebased basis, would have been, in today's terms, would have been, I think, $1, three kwacha for every dollar. That's what it was, three kwacha. With three kwacha, you'd buy a dollar. Today, by the time President Lungu was leaving, I think the exchange rate had gone to, I think his maximum was about 23 kwacha.
Yeah, in July it was 23, but by the time he left in August, it had come down to around 17.
That's right. Those were just basically sentiments. I think that was a reflection of the faith that, I'm not an economist, but for me, I'm looking at it to say that appreciation was simply a reading of the confidence of the anticipation of what President Hichilema was going to bring to the table. They expected discipline, expected good performance, and they expected really the opposite of President Lungu. But the decline of the kwacha, of course, other than that, those issues, is also a reflection of loss of confidence in Hichilema's leadership. That is why you see the kwacha is going crazy. So I would classify them in those categories. Basically, you inherit something, you trash it. You inherit something, you trash it. For me, not because I spent days with him for all these things, for years, I would classify Chiluba perhaps as the best president we ever had. Because he had to take the toughest decision that no president has ever taken in this country. You know, it's not easy to hurt people. It's not easy to introduce policies that you know will affect your people. But President Chiluba had no choice. In economic terms, what HH inherited from Lungu is paradise compared to what
Chiluba inherited from
Kaunda. There was no economy there. Everything was just, you'd say it was like a desert, everything broken. But he took the tough decisions. But as usual, when you may introduce policies, you don't see immediate benefits. The appreciation of the Kwacha, remember the debt forgiveness came in about 2000.
Into Mwanawasa's government.
Into Mwanawasa's. But Mwanawasa was simply reaping off, was reaping from the policies of President Chiluba. Okay, because it's like planting a tree. You will see the fruits maybe long after the person that planted is long gone. Perhaps the most difficult, I think, forward-looking decision that Chiluba ever made, in my opinion, was the decision to unbundle ZCCM, to sell it as...
Because it was a monopoly, this huge...
It was a conglomerate. It was one unit with divisions. But the idea to break it up, sell mines individually to various interested parties, I think that was the most brilliant decision which I think has transformed this country. Because what would have happened, I have no doubt in my mind, if I thought they had sold ZCCM to one entity, which was the Kafue Consortium, what would have happened is that that consortium would have gotten ZCCM for next to nothing, and they themselves would have now started selling off
the units.
The units.
And it would have made billions.
That have made far much more money, and perhaps it would have
And also that would have translated to having one from public monopoly to one private monopoly.
Private monopoly,
the
yes.
The same power now lying
in the private individuals sector. You can't control. So that was, so these were tough decisions. People died. I know this for certain. People died during the time of Chiluba because of the policies. And if Chiluba was weak, he would have faltered. But he assured the people, we have no choice. We have, I think the slogan was, we have to eat sap in the morning, sap for lunch, sap for dinner. We have no choice.
We have to walk this.
Now, those were tough decisions which made him very unpopular, but he had no choice. Now, it takes courage not to be populist, because if he was populist, he would have abandoned the policies.
Dr. Kaunda had started those policies and abandoned them several times.
Yes, I remember Kaunda was, because when he became tough, he says, listen, don't force me to start killing my own people by implementing these policies. Kaunda lost the nerve. He couldn't carry through that. You remember we started with a structural adjustment program by the IMF. We abandoned them to say, no, we'll work on our own.
We even withdrew being members of the IMF.
That's right. We said, no, we'll work on our own homegrown structural adjustment program. Those never worked. Okay, but Chiluba came in, and throughout that 10 years, he carried out some tough decisions. And by the time he was leaving, there were green shoots were coming out, but they became full-blown during the reign of President.
And subsequent presidents.
And subsequent presidents. And we came to see the full, genuine, the fruits during Arabi's time. I remember Arabi, even when he started those projects. Those projects were not started with borrowed money.
Mm-hmm.
He had surplus. Okay? And I remember Arabi even telling some of the donors to say, if you are not happy with things in Zambia,
you can leave.
You can leave. Why?
And we're not, he wasn't now relying on budget support.
No, no. I mean, we were truly a sovereign Republic of Zambia. We had control over our own destiny. That is why the president felt emboldened to even tell the donors. But again, if you are depending on 30, 40% of your budget from donors, you can't talk like that,
yeah.
You know, because they can...
pull the plug.
They can pull the plug. So,
Council, we have talked about the troubles of this country,
yes.
Troubled leadership, the difficulties and challenges we've gone through. I think we've had a full cycle. We've done 60 years.
Yes.
What should be done?
I wish I had an answer to that, but I can only theorize from myself, from my own perspective. Ambassador, it's painful. This takes me back to when I was growing up in Kitwe. If you remember, I don't know how much you know about the Copper Belt, but those from the Copper Belt would know. We used to have scenarios where Senegalese used to be rounded up in Kitwe.
In cleanups.
In cleanups and deported.
Mm.
They would come back because of these Muslim names. He comes back with a new passport under a new name. Those days, things were not computerized.
Yeah.
So there is no fingerprints. A joke, it's not really a joke, but these are things we hear behind the scenes that people from other countries that have come here in Zambia talk about these things. And I remember one exchange where a Senegalese and a Zambian were arguing. So the Zambian says, "You, Senegalese, why is it that you like coming to Zambia?
Even after we deport you."
After we deport you. Then the Senegalese laughed and says, "You know why we come here? We come here because the streets of Zambia are littered with gold. But this gold is only visible to foreigners."
Mm-hmm.
It was an offensive statement, but true. We don't see the opportunities that we have. And I'm sure we have had experiences. People that have come to this country with absolutely nothing, and they have turned themselves. I know of a number of friends that came here without education, without nothing, and then they have ended up becoming multimillionaires in dollars, whilst we, the Zambian, are still wallowing in poverty. Now, there is a reason for that. Yes, they come here, but they work hard. There is a change in attitude and everything. But in the meantime, we continue to expend our efforts on completely useless issues instead of focusing on the real issues that matter. We consume ourselves with things that are completely unnecessary. I mean, look at the issue of, we're now talking about the Barotse land issue. Really? The real issue we should be talking about is the economy. How do we transform the rest of the country? That is what we should be focusing on. But the question is, why have we not succeeded? In all these things, I think we have not been fortunate enough to have selfless leaders. All the leaders we have had.
Part of our failure is also part of leadership failure.
Leadership failure. All the leaders we have had, they've all been selfish. They start good when in office, but once in office, instead of focusing on delivering, what do? They start trying to consolidate power.
Their stem.
As a result, they begin to pay more attention on their stay as opposed to meeting their needs, the promises they made to the people. When you look at Kaunda, many people do not know this. Throughout his 27 years in power, Kaunda had only one competitive election, which he won.
The 1968 election.
The 1968 election. Okay? Which he nearly lost anyway, but that frightened him, and that's how he ended up introducing one-party state in 1972. The second competitive election was 91, which he lost.
So there are two competitive elections.
Two competitive, throughout his political career, two competitive elections, one of which he narrowly won, and the second one which he lost. But why did he introduce one-party state? Yes, there are various reasons, given stability, what and what, but the real reason was a desire to stay in power. That long stay in power destroyed things because it became uncontrollable. They embarked on policies that ultimately destroyed the economy. Mm-hmm. President Chiluba did the same thing. The changes to the constitution in 96 to Bakaunda were totally unnecessary. All what he needed, he was guaranteed of a win. But for some reason, like we have talked about, what if Kaunda wins, you know? But they don't realize that their stay is conditioned upon performance. And they don't realize that they are simply tenants in state house for a certain period.
They are not landlords.
They are not landlords. When they go, they begin to think like they are landlords.
And that the house is theirs.
That's right. Now, when you see, again, Chiluba, the biggest disaster for Chiluba was the attempt to go for a third term. Although he was a bit star-sat, though, you couldn't find his, he didn't say, but his fingerprints were all over. Mm. That, again, was an attempt to ignore the people's will. President Mwanawasa, although they talk about these things, you realize that the Mungomba Constitutional Review Commission was introduced long before the election of 2006.
Yeah.
The idea was that that constitution was supposed to come into place before the election of 2006. But what did he do? He ignored it. Because the constitution of 96 was more favorable.
He didn't want 1991.
Of 1991 as amended in 96 was more favorable. Arabi, he suited him because under the 1996 constitution, you can go in through a simple majority. Arabi also the same thing. He had no interest. In fact, he even dropped the ball. He didn't even manage to have the bill floated in the National Assembly. Then you see President Lungu. The story is still very fresh, what he did, and there was no need to go for a third term. And there is this inability to understand and respect for people. As for President Hichilema, the jury is still out, but the danger we face is what is going to happen between now and
2026.
Is Hichilema going to be selfless enough to allow the constitution to remain and ensure that there is a free and fair election with the possibility that he might lose? Is he likely to be selfless enough to allow that possibility? The indicators so far are that no, that is not likely to happen. So the biggest threat to our democracy now is between now and 2026. And that is why you have that talk about amendment of the constitution. And you have the confusion within PF. Oh, that is all politics in readiness for. I hope I'm wrong, but my reading of it all is that this is all a prelude to 2026 in terms of improving his chances of re-election. But what you see is failure. First of all, to respect the will of the people. And re-election is quite easy. It's quite easy, in my opinion, because when people elect you, they're the bosses. Now, if you have done a good job, they'll give you another chance. Now, instead of focusing on that, you have faith in the electorate to get you elected, but you lose faith for re-election from the same people. And yet it's very simple. Hey, it's like somebody, if I'm an employer, I can choose to renew your contract or not to renew.
And it's driven by performance.
It's driven by performance, yes. Now, if you are a performer, why would we fail to renew your contract? You know? But it is when you lose attention on things that matter, the thing that can guarantee you re-election. It's performance. Mm-hmm. When you fail to perform, go back to the people and explain why you have failed to perform. And if your reasons are genuine, people understand. You know, so at the end of the day, we are, like right now, we're talking politics. Who is running our businesses? It's not Zambians. You know? And my hope and prayer is that I think we'll reach a stage whereby we wake up and give priority. First of all, we need to settle this, our governance system in place. Because, again, and this is why I oppose the amendment of the Constitution, because when you go to amend the Constitution, it means you are tampering with the foundation of the country.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Let's forget the Constitution. Let's focus on building on that Constitution, which means addressing the economic and social challenges that the country face. In a nutshell, I would attribute our challenges really to governance. We have not been blessed. What we need, I think, we have to look forward is that, you know, a country is as good as its leaders. You elect crooks and criminals, that's what you will reap. You know, so I think we have to find a way in which we have to make sure that we elect good people to office. And so far, we continue to be betrayed by the people we elect.
Professor Lumumba says Africans surprise him because they get a hyena to look after the goats.
That's right.
And when the goats are eaten, then they are surprised. What would be your last words?
Ambassador, I'm a very sad person because 60 years is too long a period to remain a poor country. 60 years is too long a period to remain a developing country. If you are developing for 60 years, when are you going to truly develop? You know? And my plea would be to ask each and every Zambian to be able to reflect on this and realize that the responsibility to develop Zambia is in the hands of Zambians. We have to come to accept the fact that nobody will come and develop this country.
No one is coming for
Nobody is coming, and no amount of prayer will develop this country. The Lord has given us everything. All what we just need to do is to be responsible, each and every one of us. You see, developing a country is a collective responsibility between the governed and those given the responsibility to govern. You don't want a president who is going to behave like a headmaster telling people what to do. No, he must hear what the people are telling him and then be able to implement that. I think we need to wake up to the reality that we need to chart a new course for the country because 60 years is too long. We have to make a deliberate. What more evidence of failure do we need to gather? There is so much evidence of failure around us. And even the recent outbreak of cholera, it's a sign of a failed system, you know? And you find all these ministers reacting, what? It means that nobody has a sense of foresight.
Mm.
There is no planning. Nobody has any idea. You know, it's like a country on autopilot. And we have to stop this idea. We talk too much. We need to stop talking and do more action.
Mm-hmm.
And we must be able to accept the fact that, and we need to move away from this notion that foreign investors will develop your country. That is a myth. We have been inviting foreign investors in the last 30 years. Since the return to multi-party and free market, this country has been open for free investment, for foreign investment in the last 30 years. What is the prognosis? It's negative.
Okay? And now, out of desperation, people start now boasting about pledges.
Yeah.
Yeah. ZDA is now announcing pledges.
Oh, $40 billion.
I mean, that is nothing. That is now, again, part of manufacturing reality. But what we need to understand is Zambia can only be developed by Zambians.
Mm.
People from outside, they will come because they have seen opportunities. But again, the door should not just be open to any form of foreign investment. It has to be foreign investment that is also beneficial to the people. You see, recently the president was talking about celebrating $80 million of investment. Is it by Zambian, whatever that brewery is?
Yes, Zambia Breweries.
Zambia Breweries. Now, the point is, how much of that $80 million was actually spent here? Okay? Most of these projects, they come like a tanky project, whereby everything, including your bolts and nuts, including the labor, they're already sourced. So the only thing that maybe Zambian would be maybe concrete, okay, to provide the platform for the factory. And what is that out of the 90 million? So even when we celebrate this investment, we have to critically analyze these things. We are not opposed to foreign investment, but it has to be foreign investment which leads to a win-win situation. Because at the end of the day, don't forget, whatever dividends will be generated will be taken out to the shareholders. Okay, and here, what are we left with? Basically peanuts. So we need, I think, to do less politics, and I think let's try and focus more about the economy and try and see how we can put this country forward. Like we started off, we had said that the GDP of China in 1964 was $85. Today, the GDP per capita of China is well in excess of $15,000, whereas Zambia is just about a tenth of that, which is $1,500. But the point is that did not come as a miracle. It came through planning, wise leadership, forward thinking, and hard work. And we can do that. I'm not an advocate that we can replicate the Chinese experience, like I've heard from other opposition political parties. We have generated enough data for us to be able to chart our own economic path that can work for Zambia and based on the Zambian experience.
Oh, wonderful. This was a deep insight, not only in your life, but in the life of our country. And I think our viewers will appreciate the insights and I think reflections that you've provided. And I think for the first time, people will understand who John Sangwa
hopefully,
is.
Hopefully.
So thank you for staying with us. We're featuring, you know, Mr. John Sangwa. State Council is a partner at Smeza Sangwa, and partner is a well-renowned constitutional lawyer, and he's been very well known, you know, for his civil activism. Until next time, shalom and see you. God bless this country. God bless you. And thank you, Mr. Sangwa, for this privilege to walk with us, you know, through the life of this country, through your eyes.
Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me.
Thank you.